Yes, sir, I'll okay.
Yes, ma'am. Good morning. Today, resource person, Dr. R. Sudha, Professor Psychology, Avinashi Lingam Institute for Home Science and Higher Education for Women, Coimbatore. Good morning, participants. Education sectors must provide adults and people with adequate sex education because ignorance can be harmful. In a context of focused attention upon sex and health education, this proposed STTP aimed to reinforce sex education by exploring knowledge acquisition, attitudinal change, and skill development in sex and health education, especially for novice teachers, teachers with suboptimal teaching skills. Today's session is Problems and Professional Issue in Sexuality is going to be handled by resource person Dr. R. Sudha, Professor Psychology, Avinashi Lingam Institute for Home Science and Higher Education for Women. She completed her MPhil at Bharathiyar University, Tamil Nadu in 1995-97. She completed her MA Psychology in Bharathiyar University, Tamil Nadu in 1993-95. She completed her UGC NET, cleared for lectureship and fellowship in 1995. She completed her BSc Psychology in Avinashi Lingam Deemed University in 1990-93. She has been working as a psychologist, lecturer and counselor for more than 20 years. She is capable of lecturing in all topics of psychology and psychological assessment for IQ, personality, abilities, attitude, behavioral and adjustment problems, learning disability assessment, assessment of autism, ADHD, career counseling and other objective and subjective psychometric measures. She has handled psychotherapeutic administration of supportive psychotherapies such as relaxation and stress management therapies, cognitive and behavioral therapies. She has been working in the area of lecturing, psychological assessment and counseling for the past 20 years. She has registered with the Rehabilitation Council of India as a rehabilitation psychologist. She has attended numerous workshops and conferences in the field of psychology, disability and rehabilitation. She has conducted numerous workshops and conferences in the field of psychology, disability and rehabilitation. She has completed 11 more online courses. She has published more than 10 research papers on her credit. She has published more than 11 publications. She has given more than 9 numbers of guest lectures she has given. She has guided MSc and BSc applied psychology projects on her credit. Madam, on behalf of PACET management, principal, HOD, and on my own behalf, it gives us immense pleasure to invite for the presentation, Problems and Professional Issues in Sexuality. Over to you, madam.
Thank you, Surishji. Thank you very, very much. Good morning to everybody here. Very good morning. It's a nice and pleasant day today. So I hope you will not be bored about when I speak about problems and professional issues in sexuality. Thanks to the management of the college who has given this opportunity to us, you know, psychology teachers to talk to engineering teachers, basically. I'll just post my presentation and then give you an introduction. Give me a second. Can you see the slide, sir?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. My voice is clear too. Any disturbance, kindly let me know, sir.
Yes, madam.
Thank you so much. A very, very warm morning to everybody. We are speaking about a very sensitive topic. I'm sure you've had about 3 days of sessions on sexuality and how it is expressed in different ways and how is the status of sexuality in India and how things are going forward, what are the different professionals who are involved in it and how we can, you know, handle certain issues for adolescents and so many other things. I'm sure you have heard a lot of professionals do come and talk to you about it. Basically, I'm a psychologist, so I will be speaking to you from the psychological perspective. right? So again, introducing the concept of sexuality, I'm sure all of you must have had you know, lots of sessions about what sexuality is and all that. Again, speaking from the point of view of students, it is nothing but, it's not just about the sex, it is not about the activities, or it is not just about the sexual behavior, but it is what you feel about your body. That is very, very important. See, all of us, you know, though we are grown adults and we do have certain issues about our body. Are we happy with our body? Are we okay with the way we look? It's always, you know, always, this is a psychological fact that all of us do have that, oh, maybe I should be a little more tall. Maybe I should be a little more fair. Maybe I should be a little more, you know, shorter if you're too tall. Maybe, you know, I should be a little more slimmer. Maybe, you know, my teeth is so big, maybe it should be small. My eyes are small, it should be big. The way we feel about our body is the, you know, is where the concept of sexuality basically starts. So we need to talk about, you know, what we feel about our bodies, how we, what is our attitude towards who we are, what our bodies is, are we happy about it? Or do we feel that, oh, it can be a little better, it is not up to the mark and such kind of things. Again, making choices about your body, making healthy decisions about what you should do and what you should not do, how far you should go and how far, where you should put a stop to whatever is being forced on you, right? Again, to understand what is a relationship, to understand what is a feeling of attraction and affection that you feel for others, and to be able to, you know, demarcate it in some way or the other, discriminate the feelings that you have. Okay, since I'm a psychologist, I will be talking a lot about the emotions and feelings associated with the concept of sexuality. There is a lot, right? Since again, you know, we are sexual beings and we are emotional beings, right? So emotion and sexuality is very much connected with each other. And again, you know, how do we maintain a respectful relationship? How do we develop a proper relationship? How do we maintain it? And how do we maintain our own dignity, our own self-respect when it comes to a relationship? Are we giving too much of ourselves in a relationship? Where we should draw the line? All these are the things probably, you know, the whole concept of sexuality is a big umbrella which includes all these basic things. Right? Again, you know, the beliefs, the expectations that you have about sex and sexuality. Again, all this is influenced by your own personal experiences. Now, I have experienced only bad things when it comes to my sexuality. I'm unhappy with everything that is going on with me. Then, of course, my idea of sexuality will also be a little warped. It will not be in a, you know, absolutely in the normal paradigm. Right. Again, my upbringing is very, very important. What kind of family do I belong to? What do my parents, what are the attitudes held by my parents? What is my cultural background? We all are from the Indian culture. So, you know, somewhere or the other, it matches. But even in India, which is very, very multicultural and, you know, lots of regional restrictions are there in many, many places, and lots of religional aspects, spiritual aspects as well come into this concept of sexuality as to how sexuality is expressed by a youngster. Okay, going forward, I'm just giving you the WHO definition. I'm sure some of the earlier speakers must have given you this, but then just going on to how much it includes. You know, the whole concept of sexuality, the definition given in 2006 by WHO is a huge thing. It includes a lot of aspects, right? Now, it is, you know, it's they say it is a central aspect of the human, of being a human being, right? Throughout life, okay? And it encompasses so many things. It encompasses sex, gender identities and roles, the sexual orientation, eroticism, the pleasure and intimacy, as well as the reproductive aspects of it, right? Now, how is it experienced? That also WHO tells you. Sexuality is experienced or expressed through thoughts, desires, fantasies, beliefs, attitudes, values, behaviors, practices, roles and relationships. So these are the multiple areas where we express sexuality, right? Now, sexuality includes so many dimensions, but it is not necessary that all of us experience all these dimensions or express all these dimensions. If you have some kind of desires, probably many of us like to, you know, repress it, try to put it down, you know, try to hide it from the world. Maybe it is not according to what the, you know, social norms do not accept what we desire. That is probable, right? So we repress a lot of it also. It need not all be experienced or expressed in a way, right? Again, it is, you know, it involves a lot of, you know, paradigms, as I told you. It has a biological paradigm, it has a psychological paradigm, it has a social, economic, political, cultural, legal, historical, religious, as well as spiritual factors which influence the concept of sexuality, the experience and the expression of sexuality. So many factors are involved, not just the biology, not just the, you know, our biological organs, the sexual organs, the hormones. No, they are not the only ones. Our feelings and emotions are there, as well as, you know, what is socially acceptable, what is not socially acceptable. The economic factors, political factors that we have in each country, the milieu that we have, the cultural factors, what is right for us, what is okay for us, legal aspects are there, and how it has come forward, you know, the historical, religious and spiritual factors are very, very, very huge. We have certain religions which say certain things are sin, okay, and certain things are allowed. So all these are very, very important if we have to understand the concept of sexuality. Okay, again, I'm giving you what WHO says about sexual health. Okay, now they have spoken about mental health, they've spoken about physical health, they've also spoken about sexual health. So sexual health is very, very important for all of us to be, you know, functioning as normal, well-adjusted human beings. Okay, sexual health is a state of physical, emotional, mental, social well-being. Okay, this concept of well-being means we are okay. We are okay with ourselves. We are okay with our environment. We do not face any trouble. We do not face any problems. That is the concept of well-being according to, you know, psychological studies. Okay, sexual health is not just the absence of diseases, but yes, having a positive approach or respectful approach to sexuality and sexual relationships, as well as having safe sexual experiences, pleasurable sexual experiences, which are free from any form of force or discrimination or violence or prejudice and all these things. These things should not be there, and the experience should be positive. Right, we should have a positive attitude towards sexuality. That is very, very important for us as teachers to understand that the student who comes to us and we ourselves are sexual beings. Okay, now the student is going to explore at this age, you know, at the age that they come to us, probably in their 18, 19, 20 years, they are going to explore it. It is not, you know, it is not right to totally coerce them, totally force them, but to direct it in a positive way. To direct it in a respectful way, to direct it in a way that is not harmful or hurtful to them, right? That is our job as teachers, basically. Now, adolescents, if you look at sexuality, the parent is the first role model, followed by the teacher, right? Now, parent, how the parent has an attitude, what kind of attitude the parent has towards sexuality is very, very important. Now, most of the teenagers will think of experimenting in some way or the other. Okay, because the attraction is part of growing up. All of us have crossed this age. Though we may say that, oh, in our time, it was not like this, it was not like that, we were so good. No, let's not be that holier than thou attitude. Let's not have. Yes, we have had such, you know, desires, but then, you know, our social norms were different. The world today has the internet, which has everything in the touch of a click. Everything is available to you. Now, in this scenario of too much of temptations and everything is available to the teenager. Now, if the teenager is not going to experiment, now that is something which is very, very rare, right? Okay. Now, even though they are trying to experiment, it is our job to get them to do it in a proper way. Okay. Not get carried away and not get into trouble because of that, right? So again, you know, not all teenage relationships are about sex. That is something that we have to understand. There are so many adolescents, so many teenagers who have respectful relationships with the opposite gender, right? They do have it. So let's not close our eyes to it, right? Not every relationship between a boy and girl is about sex. Them to be curious and allow them to explore in a positive manner. That is something which is very, very necessary. All right. Now, the concept of adolescent sexuality, if you see, now, you know, it is how they are going to develop such kind of relationships. What is their identity about themselves? What is their sexual orientation? These are things which are very, very important to understand what is adolescent sexuality. Okay. Now, during adolescence, this kind of sexual exposure, you know, too much of sexual exposure is definitely dangerous. Simply because if they are going to experiment without any kind of limitations, it is definitely going to get them into trouble. So that is what makes the concept of comprehensive sexual education very, very important. The concept of CSE, I'm sure which you have been hearing through these 3 days. The concept of CSE is very, very important simply because this adolescent, the teenager, the student who comes to us has to be given this knowledge in a proper scientific manner, right? So that they are aware of the risks. They are aware of the dangers of what they are getting. So it helps them be alert. It helps them steer clear of, you know, troubles, something like infections or something like, you know, unprotected sex or, you know, any kind of pregnancy or these kind of issues, you know. It helps them steer clear of these kind of issues, any kind of abuse which is happening. These things are grave concerns which are there, right? So, but then to force them not to experiment or not to go and try is not the answer. But to get them to, you know, do it in a manner which is acceptable socially, culturally, and safe to them physically and emotionally. That is what is very, very important. Some of the statistics for you, very less, because statistics, I'm sure you've heard lots of them earlier. Now, simple things, 1 in 4 Indian women is married before 18. So that is a matter of grave concern. Before 18 years, now if the woman gets married, now probably the husband is also somewhere in the early 20s. So that doesn't make for a very, very mature couple, right? Now, they are not going to be very, very careful, right? And again, you know, when you look at the pregnancies, you know, women aged 15 to 19, 7.8 are pregnant by the time. Right, and that is the data which was given by the NFHS in 2015-16, not very early, right? Though it has reduced considerably at this point of time, but yeah, earlier it was much, much more, but now also it is there. Young girls are getting married, very young girls are getting pregnant, are becoming mothers, they themselves are children, and they have children. So there is a lot of immaturity over there. Now, I'm just giving you a small comparison between the male and female statistics that we have over here. Now, this was again taken from the WHO website. Now, if you look at the infant mortality, this is the status in India. Okay, if you look at the case of females, you know, most of the time, most of the areas, if you look, the females are at a disadvantage, are at a clear disadvantage, right? Look at the education. Females have more trouble compared to the males. So, and again, look at the employability. Females have more unemployment, more amount of them facing abuse, more amount of them getting less medical attention, and more amount of them, you know, dying early, or due to causes which need not be, which could have been avoided. This is just a comparison for you. Again, you know, let's go through the basic facts of it. Basically, we have to understand what gender or sex is. Are they the same or are they any different from each other? What is gender identity? What is sexual orientation? These are certain facts we will have to get across and move away from so that we could concentrate on the actual problems, right? So looking at the concept of gender and sex, most of the time it is changeably, it is used one for the other, but are they the same? That is something we will have to ask ourselves. Are they the same? Gender and sex are not the same. Basically, sex refers to the biology part of it, the genes and the physical characteristics of it, okay, the actual physical physiology that we have, being the male or the female, what are the characteristics that you have, the primary and the secondary sexual characteristics. That is what is sex. No, but then gender is all about your feelings. So gender is more psychological, whereas sex is more biological or physiological in nature. So when it comes to gender, how do you feel? Do you feel like a male? Do you feel like a female? What it is that makes you feel like a female? What it is that makes you, what is your identity of being a male or a female? That is what is gender about. Okay, so we'll talk about gender and its identity. Now, gender is something, you know, there is a lot of societal concerns here. There is a lot of social norms over here. Okay, there are certain norms. Every society expects that you behave in a particular manner. You are a girl of this age, you behave in a particular manner. You are a woman of this particular age, you behave, you dress, you talk, or you, you know, maintain a distance, you walk in a particular manner. This is something which the society expects, right? So society expects, it has set a sort of a, you know, code or a standard for you to follow. Now, this is what probably, you know, many of us connect to that, right? Say, for example, you know, boys are expected to love sports and girls are expected to, you know, love things like singing and dancing and playing with dolls or, you know, even cooking or something like that. Now, suddenly there is a lot of break in it. If you see, if a boy, you know, loves to do something like a classical music or something like it, is frowned upon. I can even tell you an example. Earlier, you know, when I was in Mumbai, I was working in a school, right? So there was this boy who was extremely interested, not in that beat type of music, but in classical music. He was very good in classical music. Okay, now it was not anything, you know, he used to sing very, very well. He had a lovely voice. The course of music, they told him that he has to take engineering. So what he did, he had to we tried to, you know, convince the parents to allow him to study music. He wanted to study music. The parents were of the opinion that this is for girls. We will not allow the boy to take up music or study music. So what happened was he had to take up engineering, but what happened, he kept his passion alive. He finished his engineering, but he was still in touch with the counselors, the school counselors. So he came forward, he came and spoke to us of his plans. So even in college, what he did was he was part of a music group. So he kept his passion alive. And after he finished his engineering, he finished his engineering degree. But after that, he pursued music. Then he said, convinced his parents, he took the time and said, okay, I did what you said. Now let me do what I want to do. So he convinced them. Now he's a musician, right? He's a successful musician. But it took him years to convince his parents that I want to do something which is probably not a, you know, career meant for boys. I'm not against engineering or engineers. I know this is a wrong place to talk about that. But then, you know, there are so many parents who insist that, you know, this is not a career for boys or this is not a career for girls. They have clear-cut ideas, you know. Now, these are things which the youngsters today are breaking. They are breaking these kind of set norms and trying to, you know, break the glass ceiling. We have girls who are pilots. We have girls who are doing so many things which were the careers for boys earlier. Right. So gender is something which is, you know, the meaning of gender is changing. If you see, earlier, what was gender? Now, what is gender? What are the social norms at that time? What is the social norms now? Is something which is definitely changing. It's undergoing change and it will continue to undergo change. That is something that we have to accept. So we have to also grow with the world. We have to update ourselves with what the youngsters are thinking, for us to, you know, be at par with them and understand them, understand their meanings of sex and gender. We will have to be at par with them. Okay, so we cannot be closed. Okay, I know what it is for me, that is enough. No, as a teacher, you will have to know what it is for your student. Okay, somebody who is, say, about 20, 30 years younger than you, you should know what it is, right? Again, the younger staff will have a little less difficulty in identifying with the student, but the older staff members will have difficulty in identifying with what the student wants. right? Now, gender identity, again, as I told you, is about how we feel. Do I identify with being a girl, being a woman, or do I not? The biology that I have, the physiological characteristics that I have, do I identify with that, or I have problems with it? That is something which is developing nowadays, right? So sexual orientation is who I'm physically attracted to, who I have sexual feelings for. Do I have sexual feelings for the opposite sex or not, right? Okay, now there is, again, you know, the emergence of the third gender we can see. Now, the concept of LGBT is something we have to, you know, this is a truth. It has been passed by the Supreme Court also that it is acceptable. So we as teachers have to open our eyes that this is the truth. This is existing in our country. It is not that if we close our eyes, it's not there. No, lesbian, gay, sexual, bisexual and transgenders are existing. Right, so it is defined basically by whom you are romantically or emotionally attracted to. So the orientation is defined by the kind of relationships that we want to have. All right, now transgender is not a person who identifies with his or her own sex or his or her own biology, but identifies with the other gender. The person feels like the other gender, right? So sometimes they start, you know, transgender is a person who doesn't stop at that, but tries to, you know, take a new name, tries to wear the clothes of the opposite gender and tries to behave like the other gender. Okay, just because a girl likes to wear pants all the time doesn't mean that she's a transgender. That is something that many of us rush to conclusions. Simply because a boy likes to wear kurtas, flowing dresses, doesn't mean that he's a transgender. We'll have to, and he has a shrill voice, it doesn't mean that the person is a transgender. That is something that we will have to understand. Gender is not just defined by the clothing or the hairstyle or, you know, the way you walk or the way you talk. No, it is defined by the way you feel and the way you think. That is very, very important. What is inside is what matters, not your outside. What you portray outside doesn't matter at all. All right. So that is very, very important. Now, basically, we have to understand that the concept of our bodies, do we own our bodies? That is a question many of the women, many of the girls will have to ask themselves, right? When they grow up, you know, especially in a patriarchal society like ours, we are definitely a patriarchal society in India, right? So it is a male-dominated society. Over there, you know, many of the women and girls, they are told how they should behave, what they should wear, when they should go out, when they should not go out, more important, what they should not do. So the nots, do not, will not, that is more and more there in the, you know, you don't look at yourself. Maybe we are all a little privileged, right? We have broken those ceilings and we have come out of it. But what about the, you know, the classic Indian middle-aged mentality? That is definitely patriarchal. There is a lot of gender stereotyping. There is a lot of discrimination which is going on. There is a lot of denial of access to public spaces. The girls and women are not allowed to come out of their houses, go out and talk to people or something like that. They are not allowed to, you know, carry on proper relationships or simple relationships with anybody, right? So that is always controlled by the male member of the house. Right now, a lot of body shaming, body labels are around. Hello, is there any disturbance? Can you hear me? Hello? Hello, can you hear me? Is there any disturbance? Hello? Hello? Hello, sir? Can you hear me? Am I audible? Is there any difficulty? Hello? Hello? Hello, can you hear? I can't see the message. If you could kindly open your microphone and tell me. Can you hear me? Am I audible?
Yes, madam, you are audible.
Yeah, thank you. There was some disturbance here. Yeah, fine. We have lots of body labels. We have lots of body shaming that is going on. We call people, you're so fat, you're so tall, you're too dark, you're too thin. You know, what are you wearing? You know, these clothes do not suit you at all, right? How easily we tell. How easily we tell our children, our students, why are you wearing so tight clothes? What is this? This is not allowed here. What are you wearing? You know, and what will the other people think? These are constantly available. Body shaming is always there. You know, you always call people, oh, you're fat, you're thick, you're, you know, too dark, how you're looking so bad. You know, these are things, these are labels which are given to people based on their body shape. Now, one thing, let me tell you, you know, the fat people, the so-called fat people whom we call, I'll tell you the positive aspects of each of those, you know, images which people say negative. Actually, you know, when in psychology, if we see people who are a little fat, you know, they are very, very cheerful if they allow them to be, if they do not have any kind of concern about me being fat or something like that. They are naturally, normally, their psychological tendency is to be very, very cheerful, is to have fun. Okay. Most of the people who are a little chubby are actually extroverts. They enjoy life, right? So that is something you must let yourself be, okay? Not be labeled by others and not to label yourself. There are so many youngsters who are labeling themselves. Oh, I'm so, so fat. I need to lose 10 kilos. I need to be thin. I need to be thin like this actress, that model, this model. I need to wear these kind of clothes. These doesn't suit me. I need to wear this makeup. I need to do this, that. You know, so many things young girls today have. And young boys also. They need to look cool. They need to have this kind of hairstyle, you know, gel on their hair, color on their hair. So many things, you know, to look cool, right? So people do all these things. So that is, you know, where the whole concept of identity does start. Looking at the problems, coming to the actual topic that we have, what are the problems that we have in sexuality? It is based on the identity. So that is why I spoke so much about gender identity, because based on your identity, you have gender biasing and gender discrimination, which is one of the greatest problems that we have in sexuality, right? Again, gender inequality is always there. There is a lot of stereotyping based on your role. You are a girl, you will do this. You are a boy, you will do this. There is a lot of stereotyping. I told you the example of a boy, because generally we see women are stereotyped and prejudiced and discriminated, but boys are also stereotyped. Boys are also discriminated. There is a lot of pressure on the boy. You have to earn this much money. You have to be the breadwinner of the house. The woman can't be. Right? So these kind of stereotyping is always there. There's a lot of sexual abuse and harassment which we can see throughout. You know, whenever you look at the news, there is always something or the other about sexual abuse or harassment which is going on. Gender identity is again a big, big problem that is there. Knowledge deficit is young children are not aware what it is, what is sexuality. So it is our duty to overcome this knowledge deficit and give them the awareness that what sexuality is. A lot of body image issues are there. They're not happy with who I am, what I am. Unwanted early pregnancies, lots of myths and misconceptions about sexuality, about marriage, about relationships. Lots of cultural challenges are also there. Let's go in and look at each one of them in detail. Now, gender bias and gender discrimination. Okay, looking at gender bias, basically gender bias is nothing but an unequal treatment which is given to the gender, probably one gender, based on whatever is the underlying issue. Based on whatever, you know, based on your gender, you cannot do this. So that is an unequal treatment and probably an expectation. You are from this gender, you are from this sex, so you have to do all these kind of things. The rules that we have, that itself becomes unequal, right? Okay, and favoring, you favor one gender more than the other gender just for giving opportunities. I'm talking about family. We're not talking about a college or an organization. Organization, all the organizations now are inclusive. They do not, you know, favor one gender over the other, which is so very fortunate and so very good, right? But then, again, you know, when you look at families, you know, normal middle class families, they do favor one gender over the other, where, you know, they give the male more priorities for education and employment and other social aspects. Right. So there is a lot of discriminations, and based on this discrimination, there is a prejudice. I don't like this particular gender. Okay. All women are bad drivers. This is one very, very common prejudice that is there even today. Okay. I see most of the men, you know, when they drive, they say woman driving. They say, oh, she cannot drive fast. okay, she cannot, you know, overtake, or she cannot drive properly, she will always, you know, drive slowly. These kind of things are still present, right? This is a gender bias, a very simple gender bias, I'm telling you. Gender inequality, there is, again, you know, if you look at the you know, the lower class, I'm talking about the people below the poverty line. Is there any access to the women for any kind of health services, leave alone reproductive health services? They have poor access to food, poor access to healthcare, poor access to education. Now, I'm talking about, you know, a family residing in the slum. The mother has about, you know, 5 children to feed. She has 2 boys and 3 girls, right? Now, she feeds more. She gives more roti, more rice to the boys and less to the girls. Now, this is seen in so many households. This is the truth of it. Yeah, so now, a girl, being a girl, is not justice to get less food, right? To get half the food that the boy gets. If the boy is given 1 roti or so much of rice, the girl is given just half of it. Okay, so again, you know, so many people say that, oh, don't feed the girl too much, she will grow too much in height, you won't be able to find a boy for her. Let her be small and puny, only then you'll be able to find a groom for her. These kind of things are very commonly said. Malnutrition is definitely there for the woman. In fact, the woman should be the one who should not face any kind of nutritional issues. The woman should be the one who gets better nutrition than the boy, because she has a whole concept of childbearing. She has to face pregnancy, she has to face childbirth, and quite early in the common Indian household, looking at it. So it is in fact the woman who should be given better access to these kind of things than the man, right? But that is the opposite. That is the exact opposite which is going on. Not even an equal access is given. In fact, lower access is given, which is by far very, very much a discrimination. Okay, if you look at the gender gap, professionally also, there is a lot of gender gap. Now it is less. But go to an MNC, you will definitely find this gender gap. Some of the companies, now they are employing more women in their workforce because they get more concessions from the government. But what about the time when they were not getting concessions from the government? They wouldn't employ a young girl simply because she would get married and she would take leave for delivery. She would not come to work if her children are sick, and all these kind of issues were definitely there. Right? The woman was getting lesser chance at work than the man, definitely. Okay, but now it is, thank God, these things are a little overcome, but not totally. There is still a gender gap which is existing in India, even in the academy. Okay, now there is a lot of lack of medical attention given. Malnutrition, as I told you, is extremely present in girls, more so in girls than in boys. Medical attention is given, you know, if the boy falls and hurts himself, immediate attention. But for a girl, it is delayed. Oh, you take care of it, you put some haldi on it, you put some, you know, turmeric on it or something else on it, and it will get better. So these kind of things are definitely, you know, told to the girl to, you know, follow some kind of home remedies and then go in for a treatment, but not so for a boy, right? So there is a lot of son preference in many parts of the world still, and the woman, poor thing, has to undergo repeated unspaced childbirths until she produces one son. Till then, again and again, she has to give birth. And in the process, you know, many of them die. Okay, we all talk about the Taj Mahal, right? There is a sad story behind it. I know you're talking about, you know, how Shah Jahan cut off people's hand. No, I'm talking about the person for whom he made the Taj Mahal. This woman died in childbirth. And she had to give birth again and again and again. I think it was the 11th or the 13th childbirth in which she died. Now, if a woman has to give birth to 10 children, 11 children, that is totally impossible in this kind of period. Can you just imagine yourself giving birth to 10 kids? Now, what will be your medical condition after that? Now, many of you may ask you, okay, my grandmother had 11 children, my grandmother had 13 children, and still, you know, she gave birth to a child and got up and worked in the fields. Many of the men do say this to me, right, when I tell this to them. But look at the pollution at that time, look at the pollution now. Your woman, the girl now, lives in this world, right, which is full of pollution. When you can't stand the pollution, how can the girl stand the pollution? How can the woman survive so many things? Right? When you can't stand anything, when the man is facing so much of difficulty health-wise, when men get, you know, all kinds of diabetes and this and that and all, how can a woman undergo so many childbirths? Right? There is a, this world has changed. The health is not the same it which it was at that time. No, at that time, women were working alongside men in the field. At, you know, at some point of time, I would say that the earlier age, there was some kind of equality. But in between, a lot of equality was lost in the preference for the son. Right? So equality gets lost. And since there is a lot of malnutrition given to a girl as she grows up, she cannot undergo this kind of unspaced childbirths. It is fatal for the woman. Fatal for the girl. It is not like you can just give birth and be fine. No, it is not like that. Right? There are so many complications in a childbirth which were not there at that point of time. They are there now. Right? And that is the truth of it. But medical attention is still not given to many of our girls and women. Right? And I do not know why. That is something that many of you should think of. Why it is not given. Okay. Now, women in many countries are, you know, it's not this, just I'm talking about India. There are so many third world countries where this kind of gender stereotyping is definitely going on in a big way. Right? Now, the woman is sought to be a wife and a mother. Now, a girl child is sought to be a temporary visitor to the family. Okay, I have to get her married. That is the main idea for many parents. I have to get her married as early as possible. Whatever I spent on her is going to not come back to me. I have to spend more money to get her married. Right? So, and again, you know, if she gets married, if she doesn't produce a male heir, that is again difficult for the husband's family. So, her duty is, you know, be a very meek girl. Okay, follow whatever your parents say. Do not get educated. Do all housework for everybody. Forsake your food for your brother, okay, forsake your education for your brother, get married very, very quickly and go and get married and immediately give birth to a son. Then your life is full. But the girl at that age is barely 20 and her life is over. That's it. What she's done, she's given up everything for a male and she's just given birth to another male. That is all she did. That is all. Is that all that a woman does? Is that all that is expected of a woman? Is that all that is there as a career for women? Education for women is totally, totally overlooked, right? Economic dependence is there, you know. Even though the woman is earning, many of them work. They work in fields, they work in factories, they work in offices, they work in many, many, many places. But the whole income goes to the male member. And the male decides how it is spent. She is not allowed to keep even a small portion for herself in many, many families today. Even the ones who are working in good positions, they have to hand over their income to their husbands or to their fathers. And they decide how much of it will be spent on what. Right? So this economic dependence is not breaking even though the woman is working. Right? So that is something which is there. Lot of maternal morbidity is happening if a woman gets becomes a mother very, very early. Now, basically, you know, the adolescent girl, her physical growth is not full. Her pelvic growth is totally incomplete. So in that, she has to undergo pregnancy and childbirth. So that is very, very difficult at that point of time. The study was done in Bangladesh, basically. The hypertensive disorders of pregnancy and the abortion rate were very, very higher among teenagers if they get married, if they give birth to a child before 20. Between the 20 and 34 group, it was better. There was not so much of trouble. The deaths were lesser in the 20 to 34 age group. Can you imagine a woman is dying in childbirth even today? These kind of things are still happening, right? Basically, you know, they are again, you know, many of the adolescents, you know, they are not able to get an antenatal care as well. After they give birth to the child also, they do not get care which is required, right, for a mother, for a new mother. So this again becomes fatal for many people. right? So these kind of risks are definitely there. Now the adolescent, if they are likely to get be unmarried, then more so. If it is an unmarried pregnancy, then that is totally acceptable, and we still have things like honor killing and so many things which are going on in our country, right? They get this is another study which I have quoted over here. This was done in Bangkok, basically. Now, they found that the maternal mortality among adolescents in many developing countries, they did this study in many countries, not just in their own country, but in many countries, in the developing countries, the third world countries, basically, they did. And they found that it is 80% or 5 times higher to the maternal mortality in other countries, in well-developed countries. So in well-developed countries, this concept of, you know, a woman giving birth and dying, or dying before giving birth, is very, very less. But it is 80% more in countries like ours, where there is no access to reproductive health for the woman. Okay, urbanization is another huge issue of BC. You may say that urbanization is, ma'am, an economic problem. Why are you talking about then that in sexuality? No, when the whole family moves, right, many of the families move from rural areas to urban areas. That is what we call urbanization. Now, when this happens, do you think they come and live in, you know, very wonderful houses? They come to live in slums, urban slums. Right now, in urban slums, what is the condition over there? That is a condition. That is place is, you know, is a hub for free sex, teen pregnancy, lots of abortions, lots of dangerous conditions are there. Now, there was a study which was done very recently on urban slums. So, if you look at it, the girls who are in slums, they work as domestic helps, they work in factories, they work in construction sites, in so many places they work. So, they provide with the house with money. Definitely, they contribute the economic part of it. They are contributing. And other than that, they also do the cooking, the caring for the sick and elderly, collecting water also. Okay, so all this falls under the duties of the woman who is also working outside. It is not that she's a housewife, she's sitting at home. No, the girl and woman also works and outside. At the same time, she does the cooking, collecting water, caring for elderly, sick people, everything. So all these duties, you know, this was a study again, which was sponsored by WHO. Okay, there is a lack of basic facilities. They do not have even a washroom over there. Okay, so many of them, you must have seen them, you know, I have actually seen so many people, you know, they carry this bottle with some water and they take it and go in early in the morning. If you live anywhere near a place where there is some construction happening, I'm sure if you get up at 4 o'clock, you will see a lot of these young girls and women, you know, they take bottles of water and they go into these bushes just to urinate and defecate and carry on their personal duties. Now, the thing is, how safe is it? There are instances, we have personally known instances when this kind of thing caused, you know, a snake bite or, you know, some kind of injury to the woman while she was walking in the dark and going to urinate somewhere, right? Now, in the Indian slum, you know, this was another study which was done by Jagori. Okay, this was done in an urban slum. Okay, so in an urban Indian slum, this was done in Mumbai. Okay, now in one Indian slum, what happened was the female used shared toilets and wash blocks. They had blocks, they had these common toilets where they could go. But they were scared to go there when there is light. That is, after 6 o'clock, they couldn't go up to say about 8 o'clock in the night. Morning 6 to evening 8, they could not go there. Simply because they were followed by the men. They were, there were a lot of eve teasing which was carried on, right? They were subjected to a lot of violence. So they were very, very scared to walk to the toilet, right? They experienced a lot of violence. Even when they were, you know, going to fetch water, these kind of things happen to women in slums, right? So it is not that all slums are, you know, very nice and very safe environments. No, it is not the case. Though we have the number of people living in a slum are more, right? But still the woman faces a lot of discrimination, a lot of violence over there. Okay, now this was again the global rank for India in the gender equality basis. Now looking at the gender inequality index, we are 132nd in 148. That means our rank is very, very, very below. Lots of gender inequality is there in India. Okay, so this is the United Nations Development Program. They undertook this research. Okay, in 2012. Now, gender gap. Okay, this was undertaken by the WEF, the World Economic Forum. Our rank is 101 among 136. So there also we are very, very poor. Lots of gender gap is existing. Okay. Now, again, another study which was again done in 2012 by the Organization for Economic Cooperation and Development, the OECD, they looked at the gender index or the gender equality and inequality. Again, we got only the 56th rank among 86 countries which participated. So India is way poor when it comes to gender inequality, gender gap, as well as gender available socially for women, right? So we have a lot of inequality, which is very, very relevant, which is very, very clearly shown in many studies which has been conducted. Right. Now, the next problem that we have to see is sexual harassment. Okay, now looking at sexual harassment, what is sexual harassment? It involves explicit or implicit. Explicit in the sense which can be seen outside, implicit which may not be so very clearly evident outside. It is hidden in something. But okay, they may be hidden sexual overtones, okay, including the unwelcome or inappropriate promise of rewards in exchange for sexual favors. You do this for me sexually, I will give you something in return. Now, the main thing is that it is unwelcome. Okay, India, it is called as eve teasing also. Okay, now the main idea is that the critical factor is that it is unwelcome. It may be a gesture or behavior, it may be physical contact, it may be an advance, it may be showing something very bad to the person like a pornography, it may be like, you know, demand for the sexual favor or any kind of behavior which is inappropriate, okay, which is sexually offensive and which is again unacceptable socially. Okay, the main thing we have to understand is that this, whatever the person undergoes, is totally, totally unwelcome. It can even be a stare. It can even be that somebody is stalking me, somebody is following me, somebody is looking at me all the time. I find it very, very odd. I find it very, very unwelcome. Yes, that is considered to be sexual harassment. All right. Now, what are the Indian laws that we have for sexual harassment? Basically, according to the Indian Constitution, sexual harassment is the fundamental right of a woman to gender equality. Now, this was under the Article 14 and the right to live life with dignity under Article 21. These are the two major articles under the Indian law. Now, in 1997, I do not know how many of you have heard of this judgment called as a Vishakha judgment. This was sexual harassment at workplace. This was taken up by the Supreme Court in a public interest litigation. Okay, in this judgment, it was called as a Vishakha judgment. It was in Rajasthan that this was carried out. Now, over there, this incident occurred in Rajasthan and the Supreme Court took it up. Okay, now they what did they define sexual harassment at workplace? They defined what is it, and they gave certain preventive measures and some redressal mechanisms as well. Okay, now what are the Vishakha guidelines? So according to the Vishakha guidelines, the sexual harassment of women at workplace, this act was passed in 2013. Okay, this seeks to protect women from sexual harassment in the workplace. Okay, now it gives lot of guidelines as to what is harassment and what is the punishment given for each of the offenses under this. Okay, now basically the main thing that we have to understand is that it included all women. See, you are working as a domestic help or you're working as a construction laborer and you know there is somebody there who's harassing you. You can go to court. Okay, you can go and file a complaint against that person, because even working under the even women who are working in the unorganized sector, right, like domestic helps or construction workers or factory laborers or something like that, all of them were brought into this to cover this act. Okay, all women who are working and in their place of work, if they face any kind of disturbance to them sexually, and it is totally offensive, totally unwelcome for them, they can go and file a complaint. So this is for women at workplace, the sexual harassment at workplace. This was the law which was passed by the Indian government in 2013. Okay, the again, you know, one step further, if we go towards harassment, it will become sexual abuse. So what is sexual abuse? It is called as molestation at sometimes, but it is an abusive behavior by one person upon another. Okay, it is by using force or by taking advantage of the other person. Okay, and the force is immediate or of short duration, or if it is not done frequently, it is called as a sexual assault. That is the term given by the authorities. Now, again, you know, this also includes anything which is happening in the house, anything which is happening between the husband and wife. Okay. Now, spousal sexual abuse is also one form of domestic violence. That is also considered to be rape if the woman is not willing, right? So again, any kind of forced sexual contact which is unwanted by the woman, if it is done even by her husband or ex-husband, that also constitutes rape, and that also becomes an assault. That also becomes sexual abuse. It is not that you're married to the person, the person is allowed to do anything to you. No, there is absolutely no such license given in marriage. Okay. Another organization which is working in India is called as Childline Foundation. Now, this is one organization which protects children and adolescents from abuse. Okay, now this is a foundation which says that almost 53% of Indian children, that is alarming, more than half Indian children have experienced sexual abuse of some form or the other. Now, they say before they turn 18, one in six boys. It is not that boys don't experience sexual abuse. Young boys and girls before they turn 18, they have experienced sexual abuse, one in four. So more girls than the boys. Again, they undergo some form of abuse. It is very, very alarming. One in four and one in six is something which is very close home. So we have to, you know, open our eyes that this is happening in some form or the other. And we as teachers have the duty to prevent abuse of any form and protect our children, our students from it. Okay, now very important act for you. This is called as the POCSO Act. Many of you must be aware of what is the POCSO Act, but still I will tell you. Now, this is again to deal with the child sexual abuse, which was, you know, rampant in India. It was brought forward in 2012. Okay, it came into force over there. Now, what is this POCSO? It includes reporting, recording of evidence, investigation, and speedy trial through special designated supreme special courts. All right. Now, this is very child friendly. Okay, there should be counseling which is given constantly to the child, and the recording of evidence is done in the presence of parents and in the presence of a safe other or a counselor, okay, or a medical person, whoever the child feels safe with. Suppose if the abuse is done by the parent, then the parent is not allowed to be there. Right, so it is always, you know, and there is no other person, there is no third person, there is no other relative who is allowed to be there. Okay, so if you see that abuse, maximum abuse is done by somebody who is known to the child, who is known to the person who is the victim. Right, so this is also the POCSO rule. Again, you know, if you are an organization and you come to know that there is some form of abuse, if you don't report it, it is supposed to be a crime under POCSO. All right. Now, the sexual offences under POCSO will be like, you know, any kind of assault, sexual assault, which is penetrative or not penetrative. again, which is aggravated, which is harassment. Again, under sexual harassment, if you look at the page 12 of POCSO, basically, you will understand that even if somebody is staring at a girl for a long time, a young girl who is below 18 years, right, she can report it, and that is also accounting to sexual harassment. If the girl doesn't like it, if the girl finds it unwelcome, if the girl finds that I'm disturbed because of that, any kind of stalking them, staring at them is also an offense under POCSO. That was the most brilliant thing which POCSO came in. If you can just go to Google and type POCSO, you'll get the whole law under the Gazette. Okay, so the Gazette copy is available very freely in Google. You can look at it. Make sure to look at page 12 with the, where, you know, you can even see that anybody who is even stalking the girl or staring at her, girl or boy for that matter, okay, staring at them, that is also amounting to sexual harassment. But this has to be reported by the girl or the boy, okay, who's facing it, by the victim basically. Okay, now this again, I have taken the source from the rapes that India forgot. Okay, this was from BBC News. This was reported in 2013. Now, I'll just read it out for you. It is a very touching account. You know, I found that it was very, very touching. On most days, Indian newspapers report shocking new atrocities. A 10-month-old raped by a neighbor in Delhi. An 18-month-old raped and abandoned on the streets of Calcutta. A 14-year-old raped and murdered in a police station in Uttar Pradesh. A husband facilitating his own wife's gang rape in Hora. A 65-year-old grandmother raped in Kharagpur. Now, if you look at this, there is absolutely no concern about the age. Whatever age the woman is, she is facing atrocities. That is what, you know, I put this statement forward for you. The age is not at all a matter. We see that there are lots of people who are committing such atrocities on very young children or older women as well. If you're older, if you're say 35, 40, it doesn't mean that you may not undergo this. So the woman is constantly in danger. So this is a country where one rape is reported in 21 minutes. How horrific is it? We are talking about development here. We are talking about going forward, fighting with the world communities here. And still, we have one atrocity which is committed in 21 minutes. Right? So that is something which is the truth of our country. And we as teachers have the duty to fight this at some point of time or the other and understand what abuse is and to help the victims overcome this. Okay, many of them, you know, the victims and the families are forgotten. One news is there, then they are forgotten, some other news comes up. How many of us, you know, so many times, you know, this rape is not even reported, right? Simply because there is a lonely battle for justice, and which is often, very, very often denied to the people. They are not given justice at all. Right now, in all cultures, you know, be it India, be it anywhere in the world, the rape victim is suspected of being having a collusion with the rapist. You provoked him to commit this rape, is what many of them say. Even when this Nirbhaya case was there, you see so many religious leaders coming and saying all this, right? You were out at this point of time, you were wearing these kind of clothes, you were out with your boyfriend, you fought with somebody, right? So these kind of things, the victim is the one who is the reason for this, is what is being said. Very commonly in national channels, it is reported like this. So where is the, you know, awareness? The awareness itself is lacking, right? The victims are totally traumatized and totally stigmatized. And in that also, there is only a small portion of them which is reported. Especially if the bully or if the person who is committing the crime is a family member. In most of the cases, it is a family member or a friend of the family. In almost 90% of the sexual abuse cases that is coming, the person, the victim knows who the abuser is. Okay, knows the abuser before. It's a friend of the family, it is that friendly uncle who comes home, right? So these kind of things we have to make our children aware of. So even a family member or maybe, you know, a friend whom you trust may not be trustworthy. That is something that we will have to make our children aware. We should make our students aware to be careful. Okay, the reports also do not guarantee any kind of redressal, any kind of punishment. They all come out very, very often. Again, if you see, I want to, you know, draw your attention to one case which was reported long, long ago. There was this nurse, you know, who underwent sexual abuse, sexual harassment and abuse by a member who was working in the cleaning staff, right? And he abused her, and what he did was he tried to kill her. And by then somebody came, so he left her in that state, and she was left in a vegetative state for years together. I think you must be remembering whom I'm talking to. I'm not calling out the name of the victim. No, I will not do that. But there are so many such cases where the woman is left to fight for justice. Okay, this woman was left in a vegetative state because he had, you know, tried to kill her by pressing her neck very badly. And he left her for dead, but she was not dead. And she lived on for years in that hospital only. The nurses took care of her. Her family discarded her. Her family did not come and take care of her. Again, the offender stayed in jail. Will you believe it? He stayed in jail for 5 years. After that, he has come out and he's living his life. Where this lady, after 15, 17 years of struggle, she passed away in the hospital. The nurses of the hospital took care of her. Right, they kept her alive. They fought with the management and kept her alive in the hospital, right? But then she lost the battle after 15 to 17 years of struggle, whereas the offender came out after 5 years and is leading his life very happily. Now, where is justice in this world? That is something that all of us have to understand, that there is a lack of justice when it comes to this sexual violence, right? And some cases are not even reported. That is also there. Okay, so the next problem, okay, the next problem that we can see is gender identity disorder. Okay, now what is gender identity disorder? Basically, if you do not identify with your own sexual biology or the physiology that you have, and you identify with the other gender. And that is characterized, that is called a sexual gender identity disorder, a disorder which has a strong problem of sexual orientation, right? Now, this is a disorder where there is a strong, persistent cross-gender identification. You identify with the other gender, okay, which is not yours, which is not biologically yours. And you are totally at discomfort with your own gender, okay? And this is manifested by adults. Okay, by people above the age of 18. Okay, and there is a preoccupation with altering your sexual characteristics through some kind of surgery or something like that. The source, I have taken this definition from the International Classification of Diseases, that is the ICD version 10. Okay, now the starting, where does it start? Okay, I am different, I am not identifying with the gender that I belong to. I'm overwhelmed by shame. I am not comfortable with who I am. Okay, now that is there, okay. And again, you know, because I'm like this, because I don't identify with myself, there is a lot of guilt, shame associated. The person does not talk about this to anybody else. There is a lot of hesitation over there to say to somebody that I don't feel like this, or I feel, I identify with the other gender. I'm not happy with my own sex or my own biology. Now, there is a lot of shame associated with it. Okay, now how do they compensate for this guilt and shame? Many of them get into drugs, get into any kind of addiction of some sort. Okay, some of them, they confirm. They say, okay, let it be, you know, whatever I'm feeling, let it be. But I am going to identify with whatever gender I have got. Let me just struggle and let me just cope with it. Right, again, some of them, they struggle with the sexuality and they lose the battle. That is when they go in for any kind of surgical correction of some sort or the other. Okay, so this was the stages was given by a transgender. Okay, and this transgender is now working in the Indian Army. All right, so that is the beauty of it. market. Now, I'm telling you, this kind of non-conformity is not only for girls. It is there more for boys. Now, the boys face it even more difficultly. Let's see what is the case for boys and girls. How is the case of non-conformity for boys and non-conformity for girls? When you don't conform, when you don't identify with your own gender, what happens? Okay, so there is a penalty for non-conformity. So this was given by a school student. There are lots of researches which was done. This is part of one research. I've just quoted the school student itself who has a non-conformity with being a boy. He identifies with being a girl. Okay, there is a penalty for non-conformity. In this school, if you're gay, if you're too sensitive, too stupid, too smart, too shy, too gregarious, too bookish, or too artsy. Artsy means very artistic. Or if you're very good with numbers, with members of the other sex, or very bad with them. Okay, if you're too friendly with a girl, that is also bad. You're called a gay because you want to have relations, you know. Or if you're very friendly with a boy, that is also bad, right? Or if you're very bad with the members of the same sex or opposite sex, again, that is bad. So the school student says, I don't know how to be. Whatever I do, people are teasing me. People are bullying. So for boys, it is clearly bullying, which is the result of this kind of non-conformity. Okay. Now, again, gay is a tag. This was given by a college student. Gay is a tag that attaches in the absence of knowledge of one's sexual orientation. When a man fails to be approved as a man by other men. So somewhere on this college student's mind, he says that I am a man and I should be given this validation by the other men in the society, not by somebody else, right? So only if the other men give me a validation, I am approved or I am considered to be a man, right? So that is the bullying which happens to men. Okay, for girls, how is the picture? Now, very, very surprisingly over here, they found in the research, for girls, it is so much better. They don't have this much of trouble in schools, right? Now, girls who are not behaving girlishly, who are like tomboys, right? Who are cool, who, you know, run and jump and behave like boys. No, they play football. This was given by a school girl herself. They play football, ride horses, do not wax their legs. They do not date men. They get into physical fights. They bust their hair. Bust their hair means cut it very, very short. They have these boy cuts. They wear oversized shirts and they dominate, right? Even now, you know, even now in a normal place, you go to a restaurant, you have a girl who has a boy cut and wearing a shirt and pant, you know. They say, oh, you're a girl or a boy? They very well know that this is a girl, but still they come and tell you, oh, you're dressed like a boy. I mistook you for a boy, right? This is there always. Coming back to the recount of this girl, they fantasize about their teachers, they kiss their cousins. They confess celebrity crushes on Bollywood divas and openly compliment a pretty girl. These tomboys are part of the cool circle. They tell non-veg jokes also. And at times, they are supposed to be very, very cool, right? They are James Bond. They are like James Bond. And in the truest sense of the word, right? So this was given by the school girl and they said that girls have it. This research finally found out that in schools and colleges, girls who are tomboys, girls who are non-conforming with their own gender identity do not have that much trouble. They are considered to be tomboys. They are considered to be the ones, you know, who are leading the pack, who are doing all kinds of naughty things, getting into trouble, right? But then, you know, they are supposed to be very, very cool, right? But the boys who are effeminate, who are not like boys, who do not behave like the social norms of boys, who are, you know, very feminine in their nature, who, you know, talk with a shrill voice, they have it very, very bad. So over here somewhere, you know, when you talk about gender identity, for men, it is supposed to be extremely difficult. But for girls, it is not that very bad. I don't say that it's good, but yes, it is not that very bad. Okay. Now, this is a recount I give you of a girl over here. Okay. Now, this girl, you know, I have changed her name, of course. I've put her name here as Nadika. Her name was somewhere rhyming. She says, till the age of 17, I did not have a word for who I was or could be. I did not know that I was a transgender girl. But as a 16-year-old, I discovered the internet. And the title of the blog is The Smartphone Freed Me. Right? She found out that she did not identify with her gender and it was not bad. It was not something to be ashamed about. Right? Yeah. But then, you know, it is not always so good, as I told you, for boys. Okay. So here is a case I'm reporting from a Madurai college, which happened in 2019, not so very far away, in 2019, last year, March, this happened. To first year economics student at a private, it was a private Madurai college, they committed suicide, right? Why? They were unable to bear the harassment because they were friends with each other and they were bullied and ragged by their seniors, by their own classmates, by the teachers also. Very, very sad to say, even the teachers had bullied them based on their close friendship. Oh, you're so friendly with that boy. Right. So these two had no other go but to commit suicide. Right. So these are actually troubles which are seen. Okay. If you see, you know, this is another recount. I have given you a website over here. Kindly, if you get time, kindly visit this website, genderdiversityandschools.in. Okay. This is about a huge research which was carried out throughout Pan India research, which was carried out in many schools. Okay. And they found this. Now, many of them, you know, they are bullied. They are bullied based on their gender identity. The bullied participants, what do they report? They report isolation. They are left alone to face all these troubles. There is no help at all for them. They are depressed. Their grades fall drastically because they cannot concentrate on their studies. Okay. And there is a lot of suicidal ideation. They feel it is not worth living. Okay. They don't want to come to college. They don't want to come to school because they face a lot of ridicule over there. They face a lot of bullying over there. Okay. But sometimes some of them excel academically also. Okay. But in the other perspective, some of them, they love school because in their families, they face a lot of problems. Their families do not accept this kind of gender identity that they have, problem that they have, and they keep on bullying them. So they come to school and they try to express themselves. They feel that going to a college or going to a school is relieving for them. Okay. This, and the mainly what was suggested from this whole research was that comprehensive sexuality education, CSE, is very, very necessary. Okay. And it has to be given simply so that equal respect is given for all diverse people, all kinds of sexually diverse people. Okay. And there should be a lot of, you know, government should make a lot of policies to create schools and colleges which are inclusive, right? Which have a gender diversity, which are including of all people, irrespective of their gender preferences. Which is it. Okay, before we go, I would like to show you a video. Sir, I'll show the video, then we can, I think, break for tea. I'll just show a video on, you know, transgender issues. Is that okay, sir? Yeah.
Stop, 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 stop पूरी फोर्स थी और संग में मीडिया भी थी, उन्होंने ये लगाया कि यहाँ पे ऑफिस में हम लोग लोगों को इकट्ठा करते हैं, सबको सिखाते हैं, फिर फिल्म बनाते हैं, लोगों को फिल्म दिखाते हैं और जो स्टेक होल्डर टाइप के नेता वगैरह होते हैं उनको हम लड़के सप्लाई करते हैं।
Using 377 as a thing, they created a situation where it is impossible, like the fear prevented people from coming out and seeking information. Because there is no legal recognition, because there is no social acceptance, the hate community continues to remain.
Trailer of a film called Breaking Free. If you get any opportunity, you can see it. It's a very touching film on people with gender identity disorder, people who are gay and who were considered criminals. But again, the Supreme Court passed the law to, you know, decriminalize Section 377 very lately. So the thing is that it shows the struggle that these people underwent to express themselves, to get themselves to be understood. Right, I'm just showing you one more video. After that, we can probably break. Next, please.
The best thing for me about being a lesbian is total erotic satisfaction and endless possibilities. For a while, he was one of the founding members of the AIDS Bheta Virodhi Andolan, and we'd done odd bits of work together on other issues. And he was back in Delhi practicing law. That little book actually is probably one of the first such publications that came out in India. And it was really a fantastic study of the gay rights issue in India and putting it in the perspective of rights and also in a historical constitutional perspective. When the film came out, it was passed by the Indian censors without one cut, which was stunning and very far thinking. And then it went into the theaters. It ran in the movie theaters in India for a week. And overnight, the Shiv Sena, which is a political party in Bombay, started trashing the walls and saying that the film and what it portrayed was against Bharatiya Sanskriti, against the Indian culture. And, you know, overnight, wherever it was playing, it started getting trashed. And the cry was that there are no lesbians in India. And this is, you know, a thing of the evil West. And it was playing at Regal here in Connaught Place, and that night there was a vigil with candlelight. That was the first night that the movie was trashed. And as far as the eye could see, there were women with placards and young men. And the placards all said, "We are Indians and we are lesbians." And it was like, you know, holy shit, this is cool. Thank you.
much change from the time when we first filed in 2001.
Yeah.
The
NAS Foundation.
The NAS Foundation filed in 2001. At that time, it was explicitly told that no one was willing to stick their neck out. And because we were an HIV/AIDS service organization, we could do it.
Yeah.
Which we did.
में वॉइसेस एजेंसी 77 नाम के एक संगठन के साथ हमने भी याचिका दायर की थी दिल्ली उच्च न्यायालय में हाई कोर्ट में जो शाह मुरलीधर जस्टिस की जजमेंट थी उसमें हम शामिल थे
We got an amazing judgment from the Delhi High Court and the judges basically said that what matters is not the public morality but constitutional morality
Break for tea for 10-15 minutes?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, we'll get back. Thank you. Thank you so much.
Okay. Dear participants, small break. You can join by 11:20. Excuse me, madam. Shall we start, madam?
Yes, sir. We can start
already. Yes, madam.
Your participants have come back?
Yes, ma'am. They are getting back.
Yeah, sure. We'll start. Okay. Any doubts till now? Anybody wants to discuss anything? Any doubts you have? Kindly, you can tell me. Anybody? You have anything that you want to discuss? Any doubts you have, you can kindly tell me before we go forward. Any doubts? Anybody wants to discuss anything?
Participants, do you have any questions?
Anybody, any questions, any doubts, you can tell me now or we can discuss later also. Okay, I'll go back and put a video for you. I have a video showing some of the young people who are talking about what sexuality is for them and what is their understanding of sexuality and how it is portrayed, what are the troubles which are there. Okay, young people from colleges around India. Okay, so I'll just put forward that video for you.
Which defines an economy also.
Just becoming pregnant at an early age.
without being prepared for it physically, mentally, emotionally is huge in terms of how a person will be able to contribute to the workforce, contribute to whatever sort of development of the country that you might want them to contribute to in future.
It's important that people sitting in big offices and all our policymakers step out and actually face the reality that there are thousands and thousands of kids out there who are scared to go to a doctor because of the taboo that has been created in society. So for government's responsibility to make its physical presence felt, you have good policy, but we just don't see it being implemented as young people. Where we need to start is basically more information and removing the taboo on sexual health. There should be comprehensive sexuality education programs. There need to be institutions or like a cell in college that talks about sexual health or a counselor that you can go to and talk to about these issues. For the next generation and to prevent the kind of health issues that we are facing and the kind of adversities that we might have to face in the future.
Demographically, India has a huge population of the youth. So when you ensure the services to them, you're not only ensuring that they are healthy in the present, but also in the future.
So if you, I don't know if you saw that particular slide, that particular in the video, there were some slides as well, right? So it says that India's economy would go to 500 trillion if the young girls got married a little late. So that is something that we have to realize. Indian government is also having this dream of trillion economy. So this trillion economy can be achieved only if we pay a little attention to the sexual and reproductive health of the youngsters. I'll just put the slide back. Can you see the slide?
Yes, madam. Slide is visible.
Yeah. Thank you so much. Thank you. Okay, so this is where we stopped. I think we stopped about the bullying which was happening due to gender identity disorder and how women faced a little less bullying, girls faced a little less bullying compared to boys who faced a lot of victimization, a lot of bullying because they had a little bit of gender identity disorder. Now, okay, the next problem or the final problems that we come to, the last set of problems that we come to are knowledge deficits. Now, many adolescents, they do not have the correct knowledge. Scientific knowledge is not there about how their bodies work, about sexuality, about their sexual rights. They do not have awareness. How many of them are actually aware that, you know, they are going to get their periods or something like that? You know, children are not aware. They are not prepared for this kind of sexuality of their bodies. Parents do not talk to them. Teachers do not talk to them. So there is lack of awareness. Whatever awareness they get is from the social media, is from the internet and such things, which may be filled with misconceptions. It may not be correct, right? And they are not aware that this is not correct as well. So there is a lot of knowledge deficits or wrong knowledge which is taking the place. So that is where the need for sexual education comes in. Okay. The next issue that we have to speak about is body image issue. Very, very common among girls, young girls, women. More than 70% of the girls today, this was a very recent research which was conducted just concluded just in February this year, in February 2020, it concluded that almost 70% of the girls and women, they conducted it across nations, across different nations, and found out that many of them, almost 70% of the women and girls, face this kind of body image issues. They are not happy with how they are. They think that they are very fat, they need to thin down, they need to lose some weight, or they need to put on weight. They have, you know, they are too dark, too thin. This kind of body image issues are very, very common among girls than men. But men do have. I'm not saying that men will not have, but the percentage is a little lesser for the men and boys. Okay, so what is this negative body image or the body image issue that I'm talking about? You see, you think that you are not attractive, you are not good looking, right? And this starts early in childhood. Okay, and this, why this becomes a body image disorder? Simply because you keep hearing these comments from your family members, from your peers, from your friends, from your neighbors, from so many people outside, oh, you're fat, you're thin. So they keep hearing these kind of body shaming words, right? So it becomes part of your personality. Again and again and again, if somebody tells you something, you start to believe it. That is human tendency, right? So these negative body image occurs because of that, because of this negative feedback that you keep getting. And second, a personality issue where you have, when you want perfectionism, and when you're very, very self-critical, when you're too rude to yourself. Some people say, I am my biggest critic. I tell them, please be a little kind to yourself, right? If you're your biggest critic, who will be your biggest fan? Who will respect yourself better than yourself? If you don't respect yourself, if you don't love yourself, nobody else will love you. That is there, right? So in psychology, we have lots of people who are highly self-critical, highly having images of perfectionism. I have to be perfect. I have to do this. Otherwise, I'm useless. You know, so these kind of people get into these kind of body image issues very, very easily. Okay, the next problem that we have where sexuality is concerned is early marriages. Early marriage means early pregnancy. And again, younger pregnancy means more fatality, more maternal mortality, right? So this data was given in 2006, right? So almost half of the women aged 20 to 24 were married by the age of 18 years. So that is what is India like, okay? A lot of child marriages were happening. It has declined. It has definitely declined. But okay, with 27 people are married before 18 years. 27 people of women were married before 18 years. Okay, so the 27% means about 2 million girls were married before the age of 18. It's not something to be proud of, definitely, right? And again, the more instances in rural areas than in urban areas were found. Okay, so again, I'm just borrowing this poster from WHO to show you. You can probably take these posters and use it again, you know, for your lectures with your students and others to spread the awareness that child marriages should be stopped, should not be encouraged. Young women below 18 should not be married off, right? So it violates the human rights, basically. Okay, now again, unwanted and early pregnancies are a huge, huge risk to the girl, right? So again, if it is unplanned, it is more so. Okay, so the deaths are also high. You know, pregnancy and childbirth complications cause lots and lots of death among girls from the age of 15 to 19. This is another WHO poster which I have borrowed and which I am showing you so that you can take it forward and show it to your children as well. Okay, lots of myths and misconceptions about sexuality exist. The first one I call, I have borrowed this from another website. It's called as Asli Mard Syndrome. Asli Mard means actual male. You know, you are the true male, true blue male. Okay, what is it? A true blue male means you fight with people, you hit people, you are, you know, rude with people, you are aggressive, you talk rudely, you fight with people, you talk bad to a woman, these kind of things, you do some kind of eve-teasing, you don't respect a woman, all these are considered to be, you know, asli mard. You are a man, so it makes you a man to be aggressive. So that is again, you know, bad. Again, they have misconceptions that menstruation is bad. Masturbation is bad as well. Again, masturbation is bad according to some religions. Let's not get into it. Okay, so sometimes it is considered bad by children, but that is not the case. Masturbation actually relieves you, actually is good for you according to science, according to medical professionals. Okay, many of them have this misconception, I am unattractive. If I'm unugly, if I'm ugly, if I'm unattractive, that means I'm a failure. I'm useless. I cannot be as smart as the others. So smartness is attached so much to physical attractiveness, which is not the case. All right. Smartness is about how good you are in the work that you do, which I keep telling my students, and I think you should keep telling your students as well. It is not, no way is smartness attached to your good looks at all. Okay, so there is a lot of other things which they can improve upon and which all of you should go and talk to your students about, right? So many of them cannot discuss their sexuality, and some of us still think that, you know, some of the politicians and some of the political organizations still think that sexual education corrupts children. Sexual education means they will go and have more sex, right? And they say abstinence only, that is, you know, to force them not to talk to boys, do not talk to boys, do not do this, do not do that. That is what is more effective than sexual education. It has been proved beyond doubt that sexuality education programs are much, much better than these kind of, you know, old programs like abstinence only, or else not giving sexual education, fearing that it will corrupt children. In fact, it educates children. It tells them to be safe. It tells them what is their body. It tells them to respect themselves. It tells them, it gives them the power to say no when they should say no. Okay, many cultures do consider that sex is taboo. I'm giving you what a 13-year-old student had told us. Okay. Now, this was about the chapter, you know, about the sexual education program that they had got. They were undergoing the sexual education program. So she says, we did the whole chapter, did the diagrams usually. Then you had to read the whole sexual reproduction. That was 2 pages. She was the best teacher we had all year. But when this chapter came, the teacher got one of us to read the chapter aloud and then left the classroom. She entered after 20 minutes and said, the chapter is over. So they never spoke about it. It was just reading something. That is not sexuality education. Sexuality education is to talk to the children about what is your body, what does each part of your body do, and how you should stay safe. So this is something which has to be taught properly to children and not just brushed under the carpet. Lots of cultural challenges there. Many cultures, they consider that sex is taboo, sex, we should not speak about sex, and sex education is bad. So, but then, you know, as teachers, all of us, you know, I congratulate the college, you know, the organizers, that they are organizing such a lecture and calling all of you to attend it so that you will take it forward to the students of the colleges that you belong to, and probably you will educate the other fellow teachers as well, that sexuality education has to be given to the students in a comprehensive manner. They have to be taught about the biological and psychological challenges which are there, right? Many of the, you know, people do argue that India has lots of cultural traditions and we should not give sexuality education, which is again very, very wrong. Why should we talk about sexuality? Simply because the child needs information, right? The child has to get the information. Okay, so this information has to be given by a proper authority, by somebody whom the child can trust, by somebody who will give him the actual information and not some kind of myths and misconceptions, right? That is why. Second, the child needs to make certain decisions that this is what I will do and this is what I will not do, right? This is my limit. This is where I will stop somebody from coming and touching me inappropriately. So the child has to understand what an inappropriate touch is for them. right? Okay, again, there is a lot of, you know, they have to think through the outcomes. If I do this, these are the problems that I will get into. If I go and have sex with somebody at this age, then probably I have to face the outcomes. I may get pregnant. And so what happens, right? So these are the outcomes that the child should be aware of before the child is getting into this. I'm calling all of them children. Anybody lesser than 20 years to me is a child. So that way, all of them have to be aware of these kind of outcomes, right? And they have to understand, they have to know what is privacy. They have to know what is a relationship. All of them say, oh, I'm in a relationship. Most of them say that. So what is this relationship and what comes with it? That is something they have to understand. Right, there's a lot of blackmail which goes on. You know, if you love me, you will do this. You don't love me truly, so you are not doing this with me. There's a lot of this is called emotional blackmail. Many of them have to face this, so this they have to overcome. Right, so they have to understand that this is wrong. I will not submit to this. I love this person, but it doesn't mean that I should do something I'm uncomfortable with. Right? The girl should be able to make this decision. Again, the boy should be able to make this decision of by himself or herself. Right? So sex education, again, all of you must have heard a lot about what sex education is. I'm just giving it very, very briefly. It should be comprehensive. It should, you know, be based on lifelong sexual health and give you proper attitudes and beliefs and values. And it should be about your identity, your relationship and your intimacy. And it should cover a whole variety of issues. That is very, very important. Okay, who should get it? Everybody, in fact, starting from about 10 years of age, we have to start it. Okay, and some schools and families do give it even earlier, right? So even children, small children, do identify what the parts of their body are. Since the sexual abuse is happening in very, very young ages, the children should be aware that they should stop or they should raise their voice against any kind of abuse which is happening to them. Right. So basically, it starts from 10 to 19 years. 10 years onwards, it starts, and it's a crucial tool. It's a preventive tool. It is, you know, it is like a weapon for them, which they can use if there is any kind of abuse or harassment which they face. Okay, this adolescent education program was again started by the Indian government in 2005. Okay, so this program had lots of health clinics which were introduced. There was this NAR, SHS, you know, the sexual health strategy started, the reproductive and sexual health strategy started, and they started, you know, offering these kind of services for promotion of knowledge and for prevention of any kind of ills and to provide referral services for the adolescents and the youth, right? But then the sorry state of affairs is 2 years into the program, it was banned in 12 states. 12 states totally banned it. And they said it's culturally, you know, there is a problem with it. There is the content is totally inappropriate, right? What the media says. They listen to what the television says. So this concept of, you know, perfect body is also created by the media, right? And perfect figure, perfect girl, perfect boy, perfect way to be. All this is created by the media, by the social media as well. There is a lot of bullying which goes on in the social media. All these are things that we have to be aware of. Okay. And we have to help our children if they are facing it. Okay. Now, India is changing. There is a cultural change which is happening in India. If you saw that the how the Indian children are voicing that they need education, they need to know these things, they need gender diversity and they need knowledge. So that is something that most of the children are saying nowadays. Right? Now, what are the professional issues which are there in sexual education if we look at? Now, who should get sexual education? We told you already why and when. What are the topics which should be covered? How much is correct? How much is too much? And are parents the right tutors or are teachers the right tutors? Should teachers take up? How much should they take up? Should it be carried out in a large scale or small scale? These are certain professional issues that we come across. So I'm just giving you a gist of what are the topics which has to be covered in the sexuality education program. We have to cover the biology part of it, right? We have to cover about the growth and development part of it. The anatomy, basically what part does what, That is the biology and physiology. We have to cover that. Then we have to come into relationships. The second thing is that, okay, what is family life like? What do you mean by commitment to one person? What do you mean by an interpersonal relationship? Now, when we talk about interpersonal relationship, I also want to talk to you about intrapersonal relationship. What is the relationship that you have with yourself? Are you happy with what you are, who you are? Because if you're satisfied with who you are and you respect who you are, then you will probably go into a relationship on an equal basis. Now, if you think that I am bad, you know, I'm not good enough, I don't have too much of value, right? Then you will go into a relationship as a submissive person, right? So you will be happy to allow the other person to dominate you. So when you talk about interpersonal relationships in psychology, we always talk about intrapersonal relationship and then go on to interpersonal relationship. In the sense, we have to be happy with who we are, what we are. Our sense of self has to be correct, has to be a proper identity. It should not be too below what we are. It shouldn't be too above what we are as well. We should not be too superior or too inferior. But we should understand ourselves, our strengths, our weaknesses, our identity, our gender as it is in reality, in a practical way, right? Not too much, not too less. So the right amount is what is required. And then you go into a relationship. Now what happens is youngsters today rush into a relationship without understanding themselves. There, they try to understand the other person. Many people think, I can change the other person in a relationship. I can, you know, modify how that person is thinking. That person is dominating now, but that's okay. I will talk to the person through a course of, say, 2 years, 3 years, that person is going to change. Now, how many of us go into a marriage also saying that, I will change the person? Nobody is going to change. What is the agenda of your marriage to change the other person? No, that's not going to be the agenda of your marriage. Your agenda of marriage is going to be the relationship. That should be equal, right? You should be yourself. That person should be himself or herself. Only then the marriage is going to work. Now, if one person says, I am changing the other person into something else, that's not going to work, right? The marriage is not going to be long-standing. The marriage is not going to work. So these are things we have to teach our children. Right now, what is correct in our society, what is considered above the norm or outside of the norm, is something which we should not leave to the media, but we have to teach our children. These are the social values. This is the society that we are from. This is the culture that we are from. And these are the dangers that are involved if you express your sexuality. What is your relation to sexuality? Are you a sexual being? Do you recognize yourself as a sexual being? Yes, issues with reproduction, how reproduction occurs, the actual biology of it and the psychology of it, and what is the medical care that is required, and what is the age, proper age, and for experimenting and such kind of things, we have to teach them. What kind of relationship, do you trust the person enough to get into a sexual relationship with the person? That is something which is very, very important, right? And also, we have to talk to them about gender equality. And what is expected of your role? Do you realize it? Does the other person in the relationship make too much demands on you, on your role, and has a very traditional view of a man or a woman? And so if you go into a relationship with this kind of traditional gender role, then there is definitely going to be a problem. Because many young men whom I have seen in counseling. In premarital counseling also we do. So I've seen that they come with this concept of my wife. My wife will only talk to me, only listen to me, only do what I say. All that I say, my wife will do, right? So they go into a marriage with this. Now the girl who comes in has her own views, right? And she has a brain to think. They do not seem to realize it. So they expect a kind of a puppet in a marriage who will totally listen to them. That doesn't happen in any marriage, okay? If the girl is educated, uneducated, whatever she is going to bring herself, bring into the marriage her own thinking, right? So this kind of attitude towards a marriage is going to get into trouble. Same with girls. Young girls say, oh, the man I have to marry should be, you know, like this, should be strong, should be powerful, should be able to fight with 10 people at one time, you know, should be very good looking, should be handsome, should have a great job, should not listen to his parents, should listen only to me. Now, all this is, you know, a bad attitude to have. If you're going to get into a marriage like this, this is definitely going to fail, right? So these kind of awareness we have to create in the youngster, because they are definitely going to get into a relationship. So break these myths, break these unwanted expectations that they have of the other gender, which is very, very necessary. We should get them ready that abuse can happen at any time, okay, to either of the genders. So we should tell them to be aware of what they should do to resist this kind of unwanted forcible sexual attempts or any kind of abuse or harassment which may happen to them. We have to talk to them about what form of contraception is going to work for them, and to, you know, talk about it with their partner, to think about it rather than rushing into a sexual relationship without thinking of the consequences, without thinking of the outcomes. Many of them rush into a sexual relationship in the heat of the moment and then they try to regret it later on. So this should not be the case. If they are getting into a sexual relationship, it should be with understanding from both the partners what they want and how they're going to do it properly. That is something which our children need to be aware of, right? The practices, and is pleasure important to them, or what do they feel in the relationship? These are something which is very, very necessary. And last but not the least, we should talk to them about prevention of any kind of sexually transmitted infection, the STIs and the STDs. We should talk to them about this, how to prevent themselves from getting into any kind of these disorders, right? Okay, now again, you know, there are more topics, but yeah, these can be optional. You can add it or delete it depending on the group that you're talking to. Okay, pregnancy and childbirth, what are the issues there? What is contraception other than condoms? What are the other mechanisms you can use for contraception? And what is the gender-based violence which is happening? Any kind, how do you reject violence? How do you fight violence? How do you get out of a violent relationship or an abusive relationship? Sexual diversity which is present, right? So we have to make them aware of this. Where are the services available for them? How are they going to go and access these services? That is something that we have to speak to them about. Okay, we have to make our campuses LGBTQ inclusive. In the sense, we have to be gender diverse. We have to understand that a child can be having a gender identity problem. The child can have another sexual orientation, can be any of these LGBTQ, they can be bisexual. There are children who have come and asked me, ma'am, I'm bisexual, what do you think about it? There are children who have come and asked me, I'm getting into a sexual relationship, what do you think about it? So we should, as adults, keep a straight face. We should not say immediately, oh my God, what are you doing, right? We should tell them the positives and the negatives involved and allow them to make their decisions. And again, if they're getting into something harmful, okay, then we have the accountability to inform the concerned authority about it as well. Okay, if somebody is going through abuse, we have the accountability to report it as well. Okay, so we have to, you know, in our colleges, we have to have counselors or healthcare providers who will take care of these issues, right? We have to have, you know, audiovisual materials that we probably can give our students and talk to them about this. Okay, and this kind of speech should happen at least once a semester. So the children are aware that there is this person whom they can go and speak to if they have any doubts. Whom to talk to, ensure confidentiality and ethicality of conduct when you're talking about these kind of issues. Children should feel safe to come and discuss. There are students, you know, even in schools, I have worked in schools also, I have seen so many children, you know, they are so hesitant to come and speak about whatever is going on in the house. Right, there was this young boy, you know, he was facing abuse from one neighbor who was trying to teach him some maths or something like that. Now this was very, very troubling for this child. She was touching this boy inappropriately, making him come and sit in her lap and all this, and the parents were very unaware of the whole thing. This boy was so uncomfortable that he was, you know, continuously failing in this, and they kept telling that you are naughty, you are not studying in this and that, and he was so depressed about the whole thing. We had to call the parents and tell them that this is what your child is going through. The parents were totally unaware that such a thing is going on. They just sent the child for tuition to a neighbor, and who was actually abusing the child in a very bad manner. Now, these kind of things we have to identify. We have to help the children if they are going through any kind of such abuse or harassment, such things if they are going through. The child should feel safe to come and talk to you. So that is, as a teacher, your job. As a counselor, it is your job to ensure that you provide such a space. Okay. Now, this was, I'm quoting Supreme Court over here, again going back to the 377, which I was speaking about earlier. So Supreme Court says in 2018 that history owes an apology to the members of the LGBTQ community and their families, because they have delayed in providing redressal to them. They have delayed providing acceptance to this particular community, which was discriminated highly. Okay. So again, our sexual education should have a holistic perspective. It should include life skills as well. Sexuality education, the comprehensive sexuality education, the CSE, should not just be about sexuality, but it should give you skills such as communication, listening skills, okay, to make a decision. How do you make a decision to go for it or not go for it? To ask for things, to ask for help, okay, to talk to parents, to talk to others, okay. These kind of things we have to give the children. Okay, again, you know, these life skills are useful throughout their life and also in the sexual relationship that they are going to get into. And, you know, they have to recognize, they have to be aware that this is a situation where somebody is pressurizing me, somebody is forcing me, somebody is manipulating me. Okay, the child has to, or the youngster has to realize it, okay, and come out of it. So how do they realize? Through the sexuality education, through the awareness that we give them, that you will be able to resist it and you stand up for it. And the support will also be given by the health workers, right? Okay, now, again, you know, many times, you know, sexual wellness is related to mental wellness. Through my experience all these years, all these 25 years, I've seen that many people, you know, mental wellness is very much related to sexual wellness. Right, even children, you know, young children, if they face some kind of abuse, there is absolutely no wellness, right? They are depressed, they are anxious, highly stressed. So all these, you know, sexual wellness is very much related to your mental wellness. I have found this through my experience of working with youngsters, right? So again, you know, physical intimacy is in fact good for us, right? It helps to reduce this, but with the correct person. That is very, very important, with whom you have physical intimacy. That is very, very important, right? In a respectful relationship, any kind of positive experience is good for your mental health, right? Okay, now, many times it has been seen that masturbation is also linked with, you know, better body image. It lowers your stress levels, and for female or the male, the orgasm leads to, especially the female, it releases a hormone which puts you to sleep, which helps you relax a little bit. So it is definitely true. So we have to understand that this is the truth, and it should not be simply brushed under the carpet, right? This is not something to be frowned upon. This is not something to, you know, just say, oh, this doesn't exist. But it definitely does exist. That is something which is a truth. Okay, I'm just giving you some kind of professional views on what many doctors have quoted as, you know, say Dr. Vijay Nagaswamy, who's a famous psychiatrist in Chennai. He says that homosexuality is not an illness. You can read the article from The Hindu. And this was the date. You can always go back and read it in the Hindu archives, right? Okay, again, The Hindu also quotes another Dr. K.S. Jacob, who works in the Christian Medical College, Vellore. He says that medical service should be given with respect and compassion, regardless of the sexual orientation of the person. It is not that sexual orientation, if it is wrong, we should deny them any kind of treatment or any kind of compassion. Okay, now another sexologist, Dr. Reddy, he says that accept yourself, what you are, how you are, right? That is very, very important. If you deny yourself, if you are in denial, if you are ashamed of who you are, then that is not going to work for you. Accepting yourself the way you are, along with your gender, along with the positives and negatives, is very, very important to discovering yourself and growing and developing as a human being. Right now, another interesting piece by Dr. Veena Agarwal, who is a gynecologist, she says most children are not even taught the anatomically correct names for the body parts. But studies have shown that even in our traditional society, both rural and urban adolescents are engaging themselves in sexual activities. So why are we keeping them ill-informed? That is the question that ma'am posed, right? Okay, what do you think the parents can do? The parents can definitely talk to their adolescents. They can express, they can clear doubts. If the child has a doubt, the first person the child will think of to ask is the parent. Now, the parent must be ready. Keep the communication open. The parent shouldn't frown at the child on certain topics. Why are you asking me all this? This is not the age for you to discuss all this. This is what most parents say. So then the child will not go and talk to them, but rely on some other means to get the doubt cleared, which probably can, increase a lot of myths and misconceptions as well. The child is going to look it up in the Google rather than ask you. Who knows, Google gives you good things as well as the bad things, right? So now it is up to us to give the correct information to the child. Okay, these conversations are definitely not comfortable. These conversations are not easy. Right. So, but then you have to give them small examples. You have to talk to them on their level. What is their level? How much is their age? Based on that, how much is their understanding? So you talk to them based on this kind of understanding. Okay. Now ask them, what do they think about themselves? What is their body concept? What do they understand about their body parts and the functions of the different body parts? Do they realize that they are sexual beings or not? Or if it is it that the child is very, very embarrassed and we are feeling embarrassed and we are trying to evade the question, avoid the question, go away from the place. Now, these things are making your child to mistrust you and go somewhere else and clear doubts. So listen to what the child is saying is very, very important. Now, the parent and the teacher has a great, great duty. We have to teach our children to say no when they don't want it. Many of them are so, so hesitant to assert themselves, to actually make themselves heard, to raise their voices and to say no when they are uncomfortable, right? So we have to teach the young people that they have a right over their bodies and they should never feel pressurized. They should never feel forced to do something that is not right, that they feel is uncomfortable. We have the sense inside us which tells us that this is wrong. I have to stop this. So we have to encourage the child to go with it, to raise their voice, to tell no, to report if they are being harassed in some way, they are being forced in some way, right? Okay. Now, strategies, how can we overcome? Basically, we have to build awareness. That is the main thing. We have to create awareness of what sexuality is, what sexual and gender rights are. We have to tell the children that violence is not okay. We have to give them the power to raise their voice against any form of violence which happens. Okay, and we have to give them the strength to overcome any kind of stigma or discrimination which they may face in life. Okay, so we have to make sexuality as a human rights initiative. Again, for children, the life skill is to build leadership and build self-confidence and build communication. These kind of strategies we have to use, right, to overcome whatever problems. One important initiative by the government has been the Sexual Rights Initiative, the SRI. Okay, now many national organizations and certain regional organizations also took part in this. And this was promoted by the UN Human Rights Council. And it has been going on since 2006. Every year these people meet, the Sexual Rights Initiative members meet, and they discuss the issues in their region and they have a brainstorming session to, find out the issues and how they can be overcome, right? So from India, we have CREA, C-R-E-A. I will just show you some information about CREA. So all of them are participants in the Sexual Rights Initiative. From India, we have CREA. Okay, so they promote gender equality of all forms. Okay, now I am giving you, okay, before we go on to the organizations, I will just give you a small intro about what is CREA and what they do. Give me a minute to put on a video, please. Okay. That was the video from CREA. Okay, what these people are doing is they are helping a lot of children overcome their body image issues through sport, through fitness, through, you know, carrying on lots of such conversations and helping a lot of children overcome and giving them information about their sexuality. Okay, here I am putting up some of the organizations which can help. Can you see the slide, please? Can you see the slide? Can you see the slide?
Yes, madam.
Okay, okay. So these are some of the organizations I have given you, and I'll give all this to the organizers. I think they already have a copy. They can give it to you people so that you can feel free to contact these organizations if you have the need for any help. Okay. So one important organization is called Orinam. Okay, Orinam is based in Chennai. Now, this is a organization that works for gender identity. Orinam means all of us belong to the same clan, right? So again, they do lots of peer counseling, and they also get help for children, for youngsters, for people who are under distress because of their gender identity, or they undergo any kind of abuse or harassment. How they can be helped is what this organization thinks about. Do visit this site. It is very, very good. Orinam. Okay. Then again, another very, very interesting site is Tarshi. Tarshi is an acronym for talking about reproductive and sexual health issues. Very wonderfully maintained site. They have lots of information available on sex and sexuality, and they themselves conduct a lot of research, okay, on sexuality, how sexual education can be given. And they have lots of teacher-friendly material that the teacher can use if you want to impart any form of sexual education to your students. Depending on the age of the kids, they have the proper age, proper material they do have. So you can go and visit the websites definitely. And CREA's website I've given, creaworld.net. So you kindly go and visit these websites. There are more organizations that I'm talking about. InnerSight is again a site which works for LGBTQ people. Now this gives them counseling. This offers them help. This can be done online also. Okay. Another organization is called Center for Counseling. That this organization also gives professional counseling to the individual people and family members also. If they have one family member with them who is queer or who is, you know, LGBTQ, they try to, you know, counsel the family. They try to help themselves better help. They get them better help. Okay. Now, I'm giving you the name of some of the helplines for women who are in any form of crisis. I've tried to cover many organizations throughout India. One is they can even, you know, anybody who's from a slum or anybody who faces any kind of distress, you can call them and get legal help from them, which is offered free of cost. All right. Again, Pratyasha in Cochin is another free legal aid providing organization. They also give counseling. They also give psychological therapy support also to the person who is in distress. Right. Another organization, the Purnima Foundation in Kolkata, they offer counseling on all issues of sexuality, on any kind of sexual violence, domestic violence, abuse, sexual harassment in workplace, or any kind of, you know, relationship issues that you have, or legal issues. Even for senior citizens, they offer help. This is the Purnima Foundation based in Kolkata. Right. Now, again, you know, this is another organization run by the government. This is the anti-stalking and anti-obscenity cell of New Delhi, which helps women in any kind of crisis situation. So this is a helpline which is available throughout, 24-hour helpline which is available. Okay. Now, this is another one very good internet resource I found. It is called Welcoming Schools. Okay, it provides help for teachers from schools and colleges also. It provides lots of educators, you know, to help to prevent bullying. How can you create awareness for bullying in your college or school? You know, these websites do have such material which you can use. I'm again giving you the name of a few books. One book is called as a Red Book. Now, this Red Book is very useful for 10 to 14 year olds. You can have stories, there are illustrations, there are lots of small exercises through which you can teach them. One second. You can teach them about sexuality, their gender identity, and so many such things. Okay, another book is the Yellow Book. Now, Yellow Book, again, is specifically for parents and teachers. You want to help, you want to know what to talk about, when to talk about, how all this is given in this book called the Yellow Book. All these books are available in the Amazon. You can buy it from Amazon. Okay, this is a wonderful resource. Now, this is called as a Menstruopedia. It is a comic. It talks to, you know, young children from the age of 9 years, how they can overcome the menstrual hygiene issues, menstrual sanitation, how they can maintain. It is given in a comic strip manner, right? So the young girls can feel better about their bodies and they can break some myths and misconceptions. I'm just giving you an example over here. Now, there is a myth over here from this Menstruopedia only that, you know, a menstruating woman is supposed to be impure or dirty or cursed or sick. Okay, now they give a fact also for this that none of the beliefs are correct. And they say that periods are totally natural and normal. Menstrual fluid is totally, totally harmless. Okay, and again, you know, there is a myth which uses this menstruation as a tool to stop women from doing so many things. So the women, the young girls today need to be taught that menstruation is not going to stop them. It is not an illness that they have to take leave and sit at home. It is not something which is going to stop them from dancing or sport or something like that. It is going to actually encourage them. They are women. It is a celebration of womanhood rather than it being something dirty or something that needs to be hidden. No, that is not the case. Now, Again, you know, this was something where they had asked girls to write to their genitals, girls to write to their reproductive organs. Okay, so one girl writes that, hey, genitals, at the very beginning stage of my periods, I thought you were creating nuisance for me. I have always wanted to get rid of you. I don't like you, right? But then there was a time when I started feeling proud about being a girl. From that moment onwards, I got a warm feeling towards you. Now I see my ability to bring a life, new life to this world. That is important. How the notion about menstruation changed from bad to good is brought about by this girl very nicely. Another notes to my genitals over here. My organs do not identify me as who I am. You guys make me a sexual object to the society, which I am not. I am a human being who has sexual attractions and feelings. I'm angry at the society, but in the end, I project it towards you. I'm sorry, writes the girl, right? So again, we have to understand that we are all humans, irrespective of our sexual orientation. Let us be kind to people, even who are sex workers, right? Most of them, you know, most of them are trafficked, are, you know, brought into this web, you know, telling them that they will be working as domestic workers. Money is paid to their parents and they're brought to, you know, cities, and they get forced to do the sexual work. So many of them. And the sorry side of it, I'm telling you this because some of my students had done a study with the sex workers. We found that these women in Mumbai, we did this in the proper red light area in Mumbai, the girls went and did this study, right? The group consists of girls and boys, of course. They went and did this study, okay? And they found that these women, you know, they were brought from, you know, places like Bangladesh and, you know, remote areas, you know, villages, promising them work as domestic help. Okay, and then they were sold to somebody. They were given, the parents were given a lump sum, and these girls were brought in here. They were made to work probably for a month or two, then they were told to change their work, and then they were sold to somebody who was, you know, forcing them into this kind of sexual work. Okay, and most of them lived in very small units. Their unit, you know, was not even as big as a cubicle where you work. Okay, it just had a bed, that's it. There was no place to stand or move around also. That was the space that was given to this girl. And she had to take customers back to back. Okay, if she refuses, she was hit by rods. Okay, and forced to go without food for days and days together till she submits, right? So these kind of things these girls underwent. And they were also threatened that their families would be killed, that their younger brothers and sisters would be harmed. Now, these are the things that this, they used to get this girl to, you know, come submit to all these kind of things, right? And many of them, you know, they live over here, they get pregnant, they are, you know, they don't have any sanitation or hygiene which is available to them. If they get pregnant, then their children are left outside in streets. Again, no education given to them, nothing is at all is happening to them. So they are living in very, very dire circumstances. So before we, you know, frown upon them and say that she's a sexual worker, please understand this is a victim. All right, this girl has been forced to do all these things. So where is her? She is a victim who needs to be helped, right? So let us, you know, change our outlook, change our attitude and help people, right? And develop a little bit of dignity. Now, this is another video that I had to show you. Before that, I will introduce what this video was. This was started by some women in the Malayalam cinema, in the regional Malayalam cinema, right? They had made an organization called Women for Contemporary Cinema, the WCC. Now, there were lots of them, you know, they were, you know, abused in the social media because of the clothes they wore, because of the roles they took. So, you know, they started this campaign, Refuse the Abuse. I'm showing you a video which is mostly in Malayalam, but I will translate it for you after you see this video.
ఎన్ని ఇష్టాలు ഇങ്ങനെയുള്ള രീതിയിലുള്ളവരെ കുറിച്ച് സംസാരിക്കുന്നത്. ഞാൻ എപ്പോഴും ശ്രദ്ധിച്ചിട്ടുണ്ട് എന്നോട് എപ്പോഴും ഓരോ കമന്റുകളിലും ഓരോ ആളുകളോട് ചോദിക്കുന്നത്. എന്നെ പലതും ആരും മര്യാദയില്ല. സ്വയം ചോദിക്കുന്ന ചോദ്യം തന്നെ സ്വയം ചോദിച്ച് മനസ്സിലാക്കും.
ഇന്ന് സോഷ്യൽ മീഡിയ ഒരുപാട് മിസ്യൂസ് ചെയ്യപ്പെടുന്ന ഒരു കാര്യമാണ് നമുക്ക് എല്ലാം പറയാം. നമ്മളെല്ലാവരും എപ്പോഴെങ്കിലും പുള്ളിങ്ങനെ വ്യക്തമായിട്ടുണ്ടാവും. എന്റെ പേഴ്സണൽ മെസ്സേജസ് ആയിട്ടും എന്റെ പോസ്റ്റിന് താഴെ കോമെന്റ്സ് ആയിട്ടും ചിലപ്പോഴൊക്കെ ഇതുപോലെ വൾഗറായിട്ടുള്ള മെസ്സേജസോ അബ്യൂസീവ് ആയിട്ടുള്ള കോമെന്റ്സോ ഒക്കെ കിട്ടാറുണ്ട്. ഇതിനെ ഞാൻ കൺഫ്രണ്ട് ചെയ്യുമ്പോൾ അല്ലെങ്കിൽ അതൊരു ഫേക്ക് പ്രൊഫൈൽ ആയിരിക്കും അല്ലെങ്കിൽ അത് ചോദിച്ചിട്ട് അവർ തന്നെ റിയാക്ട് ചെയ്യും. ഇവരെ മനസ്സിലാക്കാത്ത കാര്യം അവരുടെ സെൽഫ് റെസ്പെക്ട് ആണ് അവർ നശിച്ചുകൊണ്ടിരിക്കുന്നത്. നമ്മളുടെ കാര്യത്തിൽ നഷ്ടമാകുന്നില്ല, അവരുടെ ഇമേജ് ആണ് അവർ സ്പോയിൽ ആകുന്നത് നമ്മളുടെ. സോ
okay, so this was the campaign which was started by them. I will translate it for you. It was like, you know, these the first girl, she was, both of them are actors in Malayalam cinema. They say that people keep commenting on the kind of clothes I wear, and she says that my family knows what I wear and they trust me, so why should the others bother about, you know, and they keep commenting about it. So I refuse to take this abuse, and you tell me that you have self respect or you don't have self respect. She says that you should ask yourself if you have self respect, and you shouldn't be asking that to me, right? The second girl says that there is a lot of personal comments which are, you know, hurtful, humiliating, harmful comments which come to me in the social media. She says that, you know, if I go to try and find out, you know, make a complaint on it, the most of them are fake profiles. Most of them, they delete their accounts if we confront them or we ask them why you're doing this to us, right? So she says that there is no need to abuse anybody in the social media, and social media is a platform which is, which should be used for positive things and not for negative things. So this was the campaign which was started very recently, about a month ago, by the women from Malayalam cinema, the female actors from Malayalam cinema, which says refuse the abuse. So that was one of the things that I wanted to tell you. Okay, now I'll go back to the slides, please. Okay, so this was the slide which I spoke to you about, refuse the abuse. Now we have to understand that what sex education is not, or what it should be not, we have understood now. What it should be about is gender equality. It should be about security and respect for one's preferred sexuality and the power of choice. So we have to move beyond abstinence and teach them to practice sexuality in a more healthier, respectful manner. That is what is important. Let us awaken to a world where everybody is equal, to a world where there is absolutely no discrimination based on one's sexuality, an environment which is non-judgmental, which doesn't judge you by your sexuality, right? A world where all of us, irrespective of our gender, feel safe and secure. A world where, you know, sexuality is not a shame, not something to be ashamed about, not something to be brushed under the carpet, not something to be hidden, but spoken about and help taken. Let us awaken. Thank you so much. I have one small video more to show you. I'll show you and then open the floor to questions. Now this video I'm showing you about how a young woman overcome their issues on sexuality about their body image through sport. This was again through Kriya. Okay, I'm just showing you this video. Kindly, you can watch it.
मेरा नाम एंजेलिना है. मैं एक मोटी लड़की हूँ. लोग मुझे मोटी मोटी बुलाते रहते हैं. समाज के लोग मुझे हमेशा चिढ़ाते रहते हैं कि वह कुछ नहीं कर सकती, वह काम नहीं कर सकती है, वह खेल नहीं सकती है, वह छोटे छोटे कपड़े नहीं पहन सकती. वह समाज, वह फुटबॉल खेलने निकलती है तो समाज के लोग कहते हैं कि इतनी मोटी लड़की फुटबॉल खेल रही है, क्या वो अपना शरीर को संभालने नहीं सक रही है, वह क्या फुटबॉल खेलेगी. उसने ठान ली कि वह दुनिया को दिखाना चाहती है कि वह फुटबॉल बहुत अच्छा खेल सकती है. वह हर लड़कियों को कहना चाहती है और समाज को भी कहना चाहती है कि वह मोटी लड़की बहुत कुछ कर सकती है और वह उन सबसे बहुत अच्छा कर सकती है.
So this was an attempt to overcome your body image issues through sport. This was an attempt which was made by Korea, and it was very successful with girls in semi-urban and rural areas as well. Okay, I conclude my presentation now. I am open to any kind of questions that you people may want to ask. Any questions, anybody? Any questions, please? Any questions? Anybody wants to discuss?
Participants, if you have any question, you can interact with the madam.
Or you can even discuss anything or your experiences, you can share with me as well. I also welcome your comments if you have any.
Participants?
Anybody?
Madam, suppose we are interested to do the social science research means, say for an example, ICSSR. Can we try for any this related issue as a project work?
Why not, sir? Why not? You can do it because they are promoting these kind of researches on gender issues. People are definitely promoting a lot of work. Government is promoting. So you can definitely try.
Yes, ma'am.
Anybody else? Anyone wants to discuss or share your experiences?
Generally, plenty of questions they used to ask, madam, in the last three slots.
Okay.
The general question everyone would like to ask you is, how can I open up my mouth in the class, particularly in co-education? It is really troublesome.
It is very, very troublesome, yes.
Because even from the parent sides also, not interested in these sort of activities. So that gives fear.
What we generally do is that, see, generally if we are organizing any kind of sexual education workshop for students, first of all, we take the parental consent if the child is small. Okay, if the child is above 18, then there is no necessity for a parental consent. Okay, now stick to general issues. Okay, general issues as to what gender is. Okay, what sex is. Are you aware of your bodies? Are you aware of the other gender? You know, that is a very good opening. You know, when I have a session with men and women, with boys and girls, I always ask the girls, what do you expect? What are your, your attitudes about the opposite gender? So this breaks the ice, you know. All of them say a lot of things about, oh, this, boys are like this, boys are like that. And boys say, oh, girls are like this, girls are like that. So it opens the floor for lots and lots of discussions. That is something you can ask in a mixed group. Okay, if you have a boys only group, you can clearly go ahead and talk to them about sexual energy and how they should express it, how to talk to a girl that they are attracted to, how can they, you know, get friendly with this person, and how to keep it within the social norms and not overdo it, and not, you know, many of them, you know, they have lots of peer issues. The other people are teasing me, the other boys are teasing me, the other girls are teasing me. So they come up with all these kind of things. So we can have healthy discussions as to how to face and overcome these kind of sexual issues. That is something we can have.
Good afternoon, ma'am. This is Nishant. As you explain, all the explanations are super, ma'am. It's a new thing. Everything is new for me. Right from the starting class, everything is new for me.
Okay.
Because while studying biology during my school days, I learned about this. After that, now only I'm getting the formal education about this. So it is new for me. As you are saying about the education to the students, my question is, how to educate our children? For example,
if a mother is there, from my learning I am speaking, ma'am, if the mother is there, it is easy for her to educate the girl child about the sex.
Yes.
And
yes.
It seems to be easy, but yes. For a father, I think it's difficult to talk about it to the male child, to his son.
Yes. It is very difficult. Yes.
It is difficult at what, how to start, and what extent we can talk, and up to what limit we can talk. So that is very difficult.
Yes.
So how to start, or how, to what extent you can explain, and what is the right age to do that for male child?
Yeah, so again, you know, when we talk about a father and a male child, basically, you know, the sexual education cannot start suddenly. Now, you have to do a lot of groundwork. Now, if you have to talk to your male child in the age of, say, 10 years, 10 is the correct age to actually start talking to your male child or female child. Female child a little earlier, because they may expect the menstruation from the age of 8 years onwards. So that is, you know, the right age. Now, again, you know, to a male child, you suddenly can't start talking, right? Now, you have to be your child's friend, first of all. You have to be able to talk to your child about so many other issues before you start talking about sexuality. Now, many parents maintain their distance with the male or the female child. Okay, I'm not gender specific here. Even, you know, sometimes the women are, you know, very businesslike in the house. I asked a gathering of women and men, you know, do you talk to your children? Right? They all said, yes, yes, we talk. Right? So I asked him, what is the conversation? So they said, eat, sleep, you know, the regular daily things. Right? So now that is not talking. Do you actually sit down? Or, you know, many said, no, I sit with the child for education. I tell him, study like this, study like that. I sit to make plans, learning plans. Did you study this? Did you study that? No, you have to finish this. Tomorrow is exam. Tomorrow is spelling test. No, that is not talking. That is, you know, very businesslike, right? You are doing your duty. That's it. But are you sitting and actually chatting with your child, enjoying with your child, talking about all kinds of rubbish and laughing and, you know, playing with your child? This is very, very essential. We have somehow lost our connect with our own children because we are very busy with our professions. We are very busy doing so many things in the house and taking care of our family responsibilities. We have lost the connect with our own child. Right. So you have to have a connect with your child, first of all, before you talk about these kind of sexual things. Only then the child will feel free to learn from you, to actually discuss with you. Otherwise, this will also be business like. You will be giving like some other, you know, teacher coming and talking about biology and going off. That is not the aim of a parent-child sexual education talk. Right. So you will have to be friendly with your child, first of all. If you want to talk about sexual issues, start much earlier. Get friendly with your child. Be comfortable with your child. Then start talking about the bodily changes which are which the child is undergoing or going to undergo. Right. That would be the correct place to start talking. What are the changes that your body is going to undergo? You know, for boys, you know, the puberty is a little later. You know, the bodily changes are a little later compared to the girls. If you go to, say, for example, you go to a class which is like a 6th standard, a 7th standard, you have girls who are big and boys are small. Right? But when you go to 11th standard, the boys are so big, suddenly there is a sprout in their growth. So you can start with this changes in the body which they are going to undergo. What age, what change will happen? Then you can take over and say the body change doesn't come alone. There are a lot of other changes which are going to happen to you. You're going to become big just like me. You're going to become an adult very soon. So how, what are the changes that you're going to undergo psychologically? Now, there is something called as a gender difference. You can start again from there. From the body, you can go on to the gender differences. What is a girl like? What is a boy like? So you're a boy. Do you identify with it? What makes you feel like a boy? Right? What makes you feel like a girl? Okay. Now, do you respect your mother is somebody, is from the other gender? So what do you think of her? Right? What do you think of the other gender? and there you go to, you know, try and differentiate between the genders and identify with your own gender and talk to your child about the gender related changes which are going to come, attraction or something. The child will feel comfortable only after, you know, talking to you about so many other things. Now, if a child has to come and tell you, Dad, I'm attracted to this girl, I find this girl hot in my class. Now, you know, a child will not suddenly come and talk to you that, you know, I find this child hot. No, maybe, you know, a child will be scared. How will my father take it? If my father is going to punish, if my father is going to, you know, treat me badly, if my father is going to, you know, frown at this. So, you know, the child should be comfortable first of all talking to you. That is what the prerequisite to talking about sexuality, which is very, very important. Have I answered you, sir?
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am. I got the answer. Thank you so much, ma'am.
There is one more question over here, which has been posted. When I'm hearing this kind of information as a father, I'm really afraid to face the future of my child in the society. One compromise is my wife is in the medical field. You have it very easy. She can handle all this, right? So I think, you know, this is very important for us as parents and as teachers as well. We should be aware that the children, we consider them, oh, they are small children, they don't know anything. But they are the youth of the future. They are the adults of the future. So we have to treat them like that. And we are the best source to give them information, the correct information, right? So it is better that they talk to us than go somewhere and find some wrong information, right? Yeah. Anybody else? Thank you for asking me this, sir. Thank you for this question. Yes,
ma'am.
Yes, please.
Ma'am, if we find it an adult with some such kind of problems, how do we have to initiate our approach?
If you find an adult or an adolescent, ma'am?
That is like an adult.
Okay. See, if you know that maybe somebody is facing this kind of trouble, again, you know, if the person is willing to talk to you, that is the first thing. Okay. Now, if the person is willing to talk to you, you have to find a private place and you have to ensure that the person trusts you and trusts that you will not go and spread this information outside. Right. So ask the person very gently as to, you know, if they are ill or is something troubling them, and if they are willing to open up, if the person is trusting you enough, the person will open up to you. And now if the person talks to you about some issue which is going on, try to help if you can help. If you have the knowledge for it, try to do it. Otherwise, try and refer the person to somebody who is qualified, who is professional to give the person the kind of help. I do not know exactly what issue you're talking about. If you can be a little more clear in your question, I can answer you better, ma'am.
That is issues which is related to sex education or like sexuality. Mm.
Okay. So these kind of things, again, you know, if you are qualified to answer these kind of queries, if the person is willing to talk to you, it is well and good. Now, if the person is not willing to talk to you, you can always refer the person to somebody who can actually guide the person in a better manner, ma'am.
Okay, ma'am. Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you. Thank you.
Madam, to extend her question,
yes,
particularly ladies faculty is facing some problem, like gen students are staring,
yeah,
jiggling,
yeah.
That
exactly.
Thing they
yeah.
do,
that is definitely there,
that yeah. happens because yeah. of some of the few students,
yeah, it does
how
happen.
They can handle this issue, because yeah. wherever I worked, I have seen one or two cases such a things happens, and we used to bring it to HOD and to tell, but still we don't know what is
you tell them don't do it, you know, they're going to overdo it. That is what happens, right?
Yes,
that is
madam.
What happens, right? You know, so we had this, I will tell you a case, you know, you can probably connect to it in a better way, in a manner. See, you know, there was this case where this lady whom we were in a college where we were working, there was this lady who came for counseling. She was a staff member, and she had you know, these male students were harassing her like anything. They used to whistle at her, they used to pass comment on her body shape, and she was a little on the heavier side, so they used to keep on making comments, personal comments on her. And the fun is that, you know, she used to get so worried about it, and they had reduced her to tears. Okay, so she refused to take that class on, right? And okay, she refused to take a class. The HOD also supported. They put her in another class. But what happened? You know, the students were there in the college. So it started in the corridor. Wherever she went, you know, they would stand behind the pillars and they would comment on her. They would whistle at her. They will make strange noises, you know, when she was passing through. So this lady was totally harassed. She came to us saying that this is the last resort and I'm going to leave my job. She was in that state. Okay, so what we did was, instead of, you know, and they tried all that, you know, calling these people and suspending them. And so when they were suspended, they came back with double force. They started overdoing it. They started doing it too much. So what we did was, we taught her to ignore it. We had to give her a lot of role play. So somebody is, you know, commenting on you. Okay, so how to take it professionally, that is very important, because this is happening to us all the time. Okay, as women, we go out, you know, we go to a classroom. The men are going to look at how you're wearing your sari, you know, are you dressed this way, that way? You know, they're going to look at you as a sexual being in front of them. They're going to look at you. That is the truth of it. That's the reality of it. Anywhere out you go, somebody is going to look at you as a sexual being. Somebody or the other is definitely going to look at you. Now, how to be professional over there? What is your job? Your job is to tease, or your job is to respond to all the teasing, or are you going to react to all this? Now, reactivity makes all this too much. You know, you have to learn to ignore it. Now, what we did was, we went with the teacher, you know, a few of us accompanied her whenever she had to get out the staff room. You know, one of us used to go with her, right? And we accompanied her, and when, you know, we told her, we held her hand and we walked with her, we helped her to ignore it. So when she started ignoring these, you know, these whistles and, you know, these noises and all that, those boys got really irritated. See, she's not even reacting to it. It was odd to them. Why is she not reacting? So let's increase it. So they increased the intensity of it and we still ignored it. And, you know, then one of us went and gave the boys an extra set of whistle and said, come on, blow it. Okay, we'll, you know, employ you as the physical education person so that you can control everybody and this and that. Now we totally diverted it. They felt totally odd. What is happening? No, they're not reacting to it. When, till the time that we punished them, till the time that we, you know, caught hold of them and tried to, you know, correct them, they increased it. Once we ignored it and once we started laughing with them. So this lady also started imitating those noises. We taught her how to make the whistle. Okay, so when the whistle came, she would also start whistling, right? So, you know, she started having fun, right? So we told her to totally ignore the personal comments, but have fun. She said, so what? I'm fat. So what? Doesn't matter, right? And she started having fun. She started dressing more properly. She started taking better care of herself. And that way, you know, we helped her overcome this issue and the whole thing lost steam. Because she was not reacting. The boy said, oh, she's not even bothered. What is the point in teasing somebody when the person is not bothering? Right. This we did in the college. And we could overcome it without punishing the boys. Again, on another hand, the physical education teacher, you know, made them aware of what bullying is, made them part of a role play where they were given roles. You know, we did that also. And what we did was, there was this workshop for, you know, which they could do in the football field. Right. So we involved all these boys specially. Okay. Now we gave them different roles. One day one boy was the bully. Then second day the same boy became the victim. Third day the boy was a bystander. So we gave all of them different roles each day. And they were given situations to enact where, you know, the bully was calling all kinds of names, you know, rude names to somebody, and the victim was standing and crying. Right. And the bystander was looking at what is all this, oh, like that. Right. So we gave them different roles. When they were the bully, they were, you know, given lots of dialogues to scold somebody, to tease somebody and all that. When they were the victim, they got it. They understood what it is like to stand in the victim's place and listen to all this. Right. So this was done with the help of the physical education teacher. Right. So we did this role play also, where they were given different roles. Now we found that the bullies toned down. They understood what it is to be called such rubbish names in front of an organ, in front of, you know, the whole audience, what it is. We made them enact it in stage also after that. Okay. So they understood what it is to be called such kind of names. What is it to be a victim? Right. And we got them to, you know, talk to us, and we got them to, you know, actually overcome the issue that they had also. They were bullies. So they had to also be helped to, they were children. They were doing it without understanding the consequences. So they had to be taught to overcome this concept of, you know, troubling somebody. Right? They have to be taught about, you know, constructive way to, you know, put your thought forward. If you have to go and talk to a teacher, go and talk to her. Why do you, you know, tease her? Why do you bully her? Right? So that is something we taught the children as well. And we taught the teacher who was the victim of this whole thing to handle it in a better way, to be more proactive, to, you know, develop a better self-image as well. So this is something we can use as a program. It is a, this was not a one-day thing. Okay, in one day you can't overcome this, but, you know, it definitely does work, right? I think I have answered your question, but yeah, this is a whole program that we did. The whole counseling team did this.
As you said in the slide, refuse the abuse.
Yes, so definitely. Refuse the abuse is important.
Ignoring
is the first mechanism we can use, followed by proactively overcoming it. Not reacting to it, not getting irritated. When you get irritated, the bully gets, you know, more power. They start doing it more. So, you know, instead be proactive about it. What can you do? You know, when you stop being angry, you know, only then thoughts come to your mind what you can do. When till the time that you're angry, any kind of emotion, you know, if it is too much, it clouds your judgment. You will not think how to overcome. So once the emotion is reduced, when you stop reacting, you become proactive. It is not that you should ignore and keep quiet and take the abuse. No. But you have to be proactive and overcome the abuse. That is what is important.
Ma'am, I have a doubt. If there is a kind of activity in a group, what about separating them as an individual and if we can able to find one of the weak student in that group and advising him or doing like some counseling for individual people, whether it will stop the such kind of activity?
It will definitely stop it, sir. The person who is a little weak has to be given assertiveness training. We have to tell them to talk out. We have to tell them to, you know, put a stop over there, right? Many of them, you know, they need a little bit of help for that. They, you know, we work with peer buddy system also, sir. It has worked very, very beautifully wherever we have, I have tried to employ it. Like, see, a child who is very timid, you know, a student who is not capable of talking back, you know, we give them a buddy. We give them a friend, okay? And that friend is a person who will hold the hand and say, come, talk, you know, come, walk, you know. A person who will motivate the person. Now, rather than a teacher motivating a student, a fellow student motivating a student works beautifully, right? So we give this peer buddy training, and the peer buddy is also somebody who's on rotation. It's not the same person who's always the peer buddy. So we employ different, you know, the student council members and all can help a lot in this, right? The student council members are my friends all the time, because I keep employing them. I keep giving them small, you know, things to do with so many children who have trouble. And I give them small rewards. I give them a bar of chocolate for the help they did. They're so happily involved in it. They get the satisfaction of helping another child as well. So, you know, you have to make them, you have to empower these kind of children through various counseling sessions, with the help of a buddy, and through individual sessions as well. So it should not be just individual sessions, but it can be somewhere where the other students are also taking part in helping that particular victim overcome the bullying.
Okay, ma'am. Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, sir. Any other person? Anybody else?
Ma'am, good afternoon.
Yes, sir. Good afternoon, sir.
My name is Yoganam. I have like one question after seeing all those, you know, related to Mr. Sureshwar and Priyadeshini ma'am's question. Woman is not exposing that much towards about the education as well as, you know, if any abuse happen, they are not that much bold enough to face this kind of situation.
Yes.
Is that, you know, is developing or still it's like...
No, it is developing, sir. The scenario is definitely changing. Women are speaking out about, you know, women are coming out and talking about whatever abuse is happening. That is why, you know, we have lots of organizations. Even in all colleges, we have this Vishakha committee, It should have. If it is not there in your organizations, find out why it is not there. You can talk to your authorities also. There should be a committee which works against sexual harassment. Every school should have a POCSO committee. Every college or organization should have, you know, who have women workers, they should have a Vishaka committee in place. At least in paper, they must have it. Okay, paper they must have had it, because they, only then they will get approval from AICTE or UGC, right? So they must have a Vishaka committee. Maybe it is not working. So you can get it to work. You can be part of the committee. You can go and revive it if it is not working, and help so many women, you know, who are facing harassment and who are not able to speak it out. So once you organize such kind of workshops, you know, one small general workshop about sexual harassment or the POCSO law or something, there will be women who are coming out and speaking. So this is one person who is there whom I can go and speak to. So that is important. Every organization has to have this nodal person, you know, who will organize this kind of workshop where the women staff will feel free to go and approach, who will trust them to go and talk to them about what is happening to them, right? So this is a very important that organizations are sensitive to this kind of thing. They have, that is why, you know, schools and colleges have a counselor to help the students. Again, the staff also needs help. It is not that if you have become a staff, you have overcome all the troubles. No, that is not the case. Right? Many times the staff also require lots of help against harassment. We are a student university. Still, we have a staff helpline. Still, there are lots of staff members who are, you know, come to us to the counseling center. The Department of Psychology in our organization takes care of the student counseling. We have a counseling center for the staff and the students. Right? So the staff also comes to us for any kind of help. They are also, you know, female staff also, you know, bully their juniors and other people. So they also require help. So we try to give them the help. We try to at least listen. We can, you know, small things we can do is at least listen to what is happening. That itself is half the problem solved. You know, most of them are, you know, totally not able to even discuss about this. So when they are free to discuss, when there is somebody to listen to them, that is half the problem solved, according to me.
Yes, yes, ma'am. You are actually you're absolutely right, ma'am. Because yeah. You know, one scenario in which the staff has been failed in 2 years back, a problem came from a girl child. Now she could not able to address her. She redirected to a male staff, but the scenario is on the girl. So the girl has came to the male staff. You know, the female staff is, she is, you know, because of her ignorance, or I don't know, like she could not able to handle that. So that's what, you know, if I see very few persons like you, ma'am, you are really, I was amazing about your speech and, you know, your thoughts and all. Like, that's really great, you know, the persons, I'm trying to say, like, staff
awareness is important.
Yeah, yes. Awareness should be more, and they should be like you kind of people, be as a frontline example for them, and you know, they have to handle those cases.
That's
what the unique change I'm also want to see.
And I will just share my number also in the chat box. If you have any kind of such issues which require any concern, you can feel free to talk to me also.
Okay. Sure, ma'am. Sure.
So I will share my name and number over there. So you can please feel free to, you know, call me. Evenings, I'm generally free. You can refer also. If anybody requires help, you can refer also. Okay. So we will be happy to help wherever we can. And kudos to the organization, you know, to the organizers who are doing this. They are spreading the good work. You know, you people will go and create awareness in your colleges where you belong to. So that is a good thing, you know, we are spreading the good work and we are trying to, you know, make more and more people aware of that this is an issue and this needs to be handled, right? So that is one thing which is very, very necessary, and they are doing it wonderfully. Thanks to Suresh sir and team, Dr. Chitra and team, you are doing a wonderful job and you are carrying this message forward, which is very, very important.
Thank you, madam. Yoganand sir, you can say which college you belong and so on.
I represent Anna University only, ma'am. So here they are working, actually they are working on this, you know, they are coming up with a cell. So where they have already anti-ragging harassment cell and all, But you know, now they, as per AICT norms, they are actually initiating about this sex education and life to students.
Yes,
they are trying
very
to
form kids. Yeah. Yeah. So you can be a member of, also since you are empowered now with the workshop and so much of information, so you can also, you know, take part in it, I'm sure.
Sure, sure, ma'am. Sure, definitely I will be there.
Yeah.
Thank you.
That's
thank
fine.
You.
That's fine. Anybody else, please? Anything you want to share? Anything you want to discuss is also welcome. Anything where you worked and you overcame, so you can share with the group, the others can also benefit.
Participants, if you have any question, you can ask, madam. Madam, good news, after the three slots, a lot of participants used to ask resource person contact details because they want to start a similar event in their institute, ma'am.
Okay, that's good.
That credit goes to resource person people like you.
Yeah, sir, thank you so much, sir. Thank you. You gave us a platform, right? We have been doing this for years now, but then you are the people who gave us a platform, right? We are people who are with the UGC, so AICT is something new to us also. So you people gave us a platform. I should say thanks to you, right?
Yes, madam.
And my sessions, sir, I thoroughly enjoyed, sir. Thoroughly enjoyed all the three sessions which I had with you. Totally enjoyed. Thanks to you, Suresh sir, and thanks to you, Chitra ma'am. Wonderful. You were so wonderful organizers, so helpful, and so patient when we lost connectivity and all those things. So patient with us. And this is, again, a little new to us also, but then it's wonderful. Thank you so much, sir. Thank you.
You covered plenty of things, madam, particularly videos, which books, students can go through, and a lot of other places where child and ladies empowerment are happening. Such a details you elaborated, madam.
Yes, ma'am. This is what I was expecting for the last 2 days. You know, no resource person has shared any links or videos or how to do or
thank
what.
You. Thank you, sir.
The first session of you is really, that was good, and more videos I was seeing. It's really good, you know. Okay, thank you for the question.
Because you know, an audio visual is more effective than one person just speaking. I also get tired, sir. So video is the rest for me also.
That's right.
Yes,
ma'am.
Benefits only. Okay.
Thank you, sir. Okay.
Shall we wind up, madam?
Sure. Thank you.
Okay,
madam.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Bye, everybody. Nice to see you all. Nice to meet you all. Bye, bye. Thank you, madam.
Your presentation would definitely enhance the quality of teaching and introduce new effective teaching behaviors and the concepts of sex and health education. It will definitely expand faculty scope of practice within the profession to include skills and insights from the STTP training that would allow faculties to more ably help students navigate through intimacy and relationship. On behalf of PACET management, principal, HOD, and on my own behalf, I would like to wholeheartedly thank you for your wonderful session, madam. Thanks a lot.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, and bye, everybody. Thank you.
Thank you so much, ma'am.
Thank you, sir. Suri, sir, I can leave?
Yes, madam. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Bye, everybody. Nice to meet you. Thank you.
Bye.
Participants, lunch break. We shall join by 2:00. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.